For over three decades, this man has single-handedly owned the ring. Love him, hate him. You got to respect him. Last night, we saw him put down his gloves for the last time. This show goes out to my man, Taker. Like I said, love him or hate him, he had one hell of a career, and I can't believe we saw him put down those gloves the last time. Sit back, man up, because this show is all about wrestling, baby.
While everybody is stuffing their face, I'm just sitting back here like, what's up, guys?
I'm drinking. It's all good. And not only that, it's opening day for the Red Sox. Yay!
Yes, indeed. Banana Tenna Denna Bama Denna 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 Deddy. Just hit a monster shot out in the right field. I got to see that. You guys look good this year. You guys look real good this year.
I'm excited. We got a hell of a team. The starting lineup was really fantastic. You got potential. But as much as opening day excites me, we have over 186 freaking games, so, you know, we got plenty of time to talk about this fucking shit. Let's talk about Wrestle Freaking Mania. Last night, we had a small group, obviously, chilling here at the Valhalla Entertainment Center.
It was fun.
And watching it upstairs, and, man, they had some incredible matches in the beginning. AJ Styles, wow, what a waste of just a great wrestler, man. I have nothing against Shane McMahon. I really don't. Shane O'Mac's a great guy. He sacrifices his own body for the company, for crying out loud. You know what I'm saying? The things that he does is absolutely amazing. It just, in my opinion, Styles should have been definitely up higher on the rankings of some of them.
He certainly should have
been
featured differently.
He was great, though. He looked great.
Everything he touches is gold.
No, absolutely. I absolutely agree with that. I think he is absolutely phenomenal, and I think he is one of the rising stars that they really need to take care of. One of the matches that a lot of people, if you weren't paying attention, you might have missed it. The cruiserweight Neville
and Austin Aries.
Man, freaking. Or did it remind you of WCW back in the day?
With like Dean Malenko and Mysterio. And
you know what I'm saying? And they were just like all over the place. Man, I got to give it to Neville. He's the real deal, man. Mm-hmm. He's the real deal. I really did think Aries had it in him to beat him this time. And when he hit him with that 450, I mean, I was like, that's it, dude.
But see, that's the kind of thing that I like is when you take two guys who are at the top of their game, put them against each other on this stage, you're going to get gold. And I'm not saying that, you know, again, we've talked about it privately, publicly, what have you. Shane McMahon, like you said, puts himself on the line when he doesn't have to. And he doesn't have to. But yeah. I do believe, you know, AJ Styles, anything he touches turns to gold. He could have a match with a broomstick and get 5 stars.
Yeah.
But he should have been featured a little bit better. I sent the tweet out yesterday, you know, owns a third of the company, opens the show. AJ shouldn't have been the opener.
I agree.
Shane McMahon, who owns a third of the company, should not have been the opener. But if you're going to kick it off, you're going to give us the goods first. Get us hyped. Walk us through.
That's what you did.
Because eventually we had to see Roman Reigns.
Yeah.
And we'll get to Roman.
Leading right after that one, obviously, we went right into, what was it?
The Jericho and Owens.
Oh, the Jericho. Yeah, it was Jericho Owens. Fantastic once again. They really gave us all these great matches in the beginning. And then, like, that extra hour that they gave you, I really felt like, man, why? Why did you do it to us? Owens damn near broke his back against the freaking ring, man. And you saw his face. He knew he was taking that.
Oh,
you know
yeah.
what I'm saying? Those of you who think that wrestling, obviously, we all know it's scripted. We all know it's fake. These guys are athletes. Don't take anything away from these guys. imagine your spine just slamming against the corner of a table. You know, essentially the same feeling, the same idea. You know what I'm saying? That's essentially what Jericho went through last night, man.
Right.
I mean, a little bit of padding, but let's be honest, if you ever watched our live thing when we're watching these rings come together, it's not a whole lot, man.
No.
It's pretty much wood. You know what I'm saying? So you're pretty much getting spiked into the corner of a table.
Especially the one we saw put together looked kind of
suspect.
Suspect, yeah.
Not saying it was suspect.
So, yeah.
Like,
so,
I think I saw one of them crazy gluing two boards together.
It's possible.
I wouldn't doubt. Probably Gorilla Glue, though. That's the way I would go.
I'm just kidding. We had a great time. Everyone had a great time.
What did you think?
Overall, I liked the show. I have no real... I mean, they threw the match I least wanted to see on the pre-show, which was Dean Ambrose versus Baron Corbin. Love me some Baron Corbin. Dean Ambrose looks like he panhandles for nickels at the corner at Stop and Shop in Norwich.
I told you when we were watching last night, man, crazy sells.
Oh.
Think about all the people that ran with that crazy gimmick that, you know, just got fans just from being crazy. You know,
you look at the guys that were in that match, and he is good at what he does. One of those guys looked like a star, and the other was Dean Ambrose. You want to see, you want to look on the television, and you want to pay your money, $9.99 a month, if you go to www.lokiandjabroni.com, click our WWE affiliate link, get the network now,
and
watch WrestleMania.
I did kind of feel like it was...
Dean Ambrose does not have a star look.
I was going to say, it did kind of feel like filet mignon put up against, like, chopsteak. You know, it's like,
yeah,
you're going to pick the flame.
Unfortunately,
every
time. You got to have some of those, like, characters, though.
Well, the shitty part is he's holding a title.
And the people.
He's an intercontinental champion, number one.
And they love
so
him.
So was the Honky Tonk Man.
That wasn't even in the
greatest
rest
of all time.
Yeah, absolutely. But it wasn't even in WrestleMania. It wasn't even in, like, the main show. You know what
right.
I'm saying? Like, it was before the show. Mm-hmm. Like, this is a title belt that is, and no offense, but AJ Styles should have been before that. You know what I'm saying? I'm a firm believer in the
you
belts.
You come for the championships.
Right, exactly. And that shit comes last. And the Intercontinental Championship is not a joke, man. It's a title with some background and with some serious freaking, you know, some serious lineage behind it. So
Ricky Steamboat, Macho Man Savage,
just Honky Tonk, fucking
Magnificent
Shawn Michaels,
yep.
Freaking
Roddy Piper for a week.
Roddy
all
Piper.
your big fucking heavyweights, they all freaking.
It was
were
the stepping stone to see if you could carry the ball on the
exactly.
next level. The
exactly.
problem is, if you look at what it is now, you have your Intercontinental Champ is Dean Ambrose, your United States Champ is Kevin Owens. These are already guys who have been to the mountaintop. Now they're being pushed backwards. They're still being
yes.
pushed to the people. Yay, root for these guys, but they're being pushed backwards. You've been on the top. Now here's like something else for you.
Well, see, that confused the hell out of me. Like, there's like way too many fucking belts right now.
Well, they turn around just like with what they did with Kevin Owens. They take mm-hmm. a belt away from him only to give him a belt in return. You know
right,
what I'm
within
saying?
A span of 30, 60 days.
Yeah, it wasn't even that. It was because literally Goldberg just got that title
in February.
It wasn't
yeah,
it fast?
Fast Lane.
So that was March 5th, dude.
Are you sure?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think
that
you're
was,
right.
That yeah. was that was March. That
I know,
was beginning of March.
That's what all the links looked like before.
That's right.
Yeah. So, I mean, he literally didn't even have this freaking title for 30 days. Goldberg took the first one from
March 5th.
Yeah. So, he lost it to Goldberg then, which obviously freaking
Lesnar wins.
Lesnar,
last night.
Yeah. Well, Lesnar came in after. Well, we'll lead into that one afterwards. But like I was saying, they take one from him to give him to another one to keep. It's like you almost kind of could have seen it coming the way that they set it up, to be honest with you. It really was.
Some of the plot lines there seemed a little recycled.
There was some pretty rough ones. I hope you saw my meme I made. Mm-hmm. Triple H be rolling into WrestleMania.
That was
like,
awesome.
No, I had not seen the meme.
Oh, you've not seen that
I
one?
I will go hunt it down.
Dude, that is freaking spectacular. I put it on Loki's memes, too. It's there.
Nice.
I actually tweeted Triple H, and I didn't get anything in return for it.
Of course you won't.
Yeah, I know. It would be fucking spectacular. If you guys have not seen this meme yet, I'll...
They will.
I fucking had to.
That's some good shit right there. That's some good shit right there. I like it.
There it is.
Now, the worst entrance, Triple H has nothing against their great. They were Miami, right?
Orlando.
Or no, Orlando. The Orlando's finest. Nothing against them giving them a, you know, six police front. But I mean, let's be honest, man. If you didn't want to walk it, fine. You know, find, you know, stroll your way on down there. You didn't have to freaking get a custom-made trike just for everybody to watch you go fucking.
I think he bought that at the local Toys R Us and just had it souped up a little bit down at Mike's Famous painted, in Orlando. Yeah.
Painted it black, you know, right. So it just kind of felt right in.
I get tired of what's he going to do this year for an entrance. Just walk to the fucking ring. Put your jacket on. Put your gimmick
but
on.
But you know, it's the same thing. Remember The Undertaker used to have that? He used to be like, oh, man, I can't wait. Those lights are going to come off. Mm-hmm. And then every once in a while, you do the lightning thing and here, there, and there.
But it was always generally the same.
Right, exactly. Triple H kind of developed this. And I'm trying to remember. Somebody else used to be. I mean, obviously, New Day is now
Shawn Michaels.
Known for
year
Shawn
after
Michaels,
year.
There you go.
Whether
Shawn Michaels
zip lining
was a big
or
one.
Taking the crane down.
He
or
would
whatever.
Always do something to modify. What is he doing this year exactly? And I think this
you can
is,
see the meme if you're watching the live stream now.
Pretty
badass.
If you really think about, you know, like what as far as coming through and what they did. I mean, Shawn Michaels.
You're starting to sound like Shawn Michaels
last night. Exactly, exactly.
Shawn, what did you think of the show? It was a good show. Thanks, King.
Triple H just—he started doing this. He started making these awesome entrances, and then I don't know. Maybe there's a time when you got to be like, "Hey, I'm not doing that no more."
Maybe he should. Maybe he should get like a electric wheelchair.
Because
he's getting old.
And
the shtick is getting old. He actually looked tired after about 4 minutes last night.
Called it last night too. Seth Rogen there looked
like the hair is running away from his face at a rapid pace.
Not only that,
I got no love for
like
Seth freaking Rollins.
Freaking Gold Power Ranger,
oh
man.
God.
Gold Power Ranger with his Skyrim,
you know,
side armor.
Right. You know, Ed had a question last night. And I thought of it today when I was looking through the results just to refresh my memory because, you know, the Vikings blood and the whiskey sours were flowing like wine, and in some cases it was wine. Why is there a referee in an unsanctioned match? Why don't they just beat the shit out of each other till one of them can't walk? And then you pin the other one in an unsanctioned match, but the referee is part of the company.
Yeah, I don't get
that. It's like playing
pick
up baseball. If the Red Sox and Yankees just decide, you know what, fuck it, we got a day off tomorrow. Let's go down to the Little League.
Basically,
field.
What my thing was, okay, it's unsanctioned, which means we don't approve this match, but we're gonna make all the titles for it, all the posters.
Yep.
Pay for fireworks.
Yep.
The intro music.
Yep.
Triple H's trike.
Yeah.
I seriously
McMahon's collagen.
I seriously wanted him to get off of that motorcycle and have the shirt that says, if you can read this, the bitch fell off. I wanted him to have that t-shirt.
I wanted to. I was doing it. When I found that Miss Piggy freaking cut that to
nice.
Be able to cut that out, I was so excited. I was like, this is so perfect. So perfect.
I know. I heard you say once you were a pretty big Triple H fan at one time.
Absolutely. When he was Hunter Hearst Helmsley, I was a fanboy.
We're going to have to
I
ask
think
the same
I was the
question.
Only one, and I remember telling you this. I went to the King of the Ring.
I was there as well.
Where
yeah.
he beat Mankind with his freaking
crown.
Because, yeah, he won it. And he beat the hell out of me, and people booed it, and I was the only one cheering, man. I was a huge fan of Triple H back then.
We got to ask the question for two guys in this, and one of them we already know the answer. It was yesterday. When does Hunter call it a day?
I agree, man. At this point, like,
move over.
He's, you know what? I blame Vince. It's your fault, Vince. You made the bosses have to act like this. Like with Vince constantly, you know, doing this, and now freaking Shane McMahon did his little match against AJ Styles. You're getting these people to say, oh, okay, this is how the corporation deals with people. They just beat the hell out of them. So the next person that we need, we hired, what's his name? Samoa Joe. So he's our you know, our muscle now or whatnot.
Right.
That image, that whole, if I'm the boss and you piss me off, you're going to make me cross the line. You know what I'm saying? Even Stephanie, that was in the promo last night. You make him be the person that he hates the most or whatever. You bring this side out of him, Seth Rollins. God damn it. And it's like, at some point, you already own this company, dude. You are running this fucking company.
It's going to be yours.
Run the company. Just do it. Just focus on that. We don't need to see you like wrestling anymore. Maybe it's fun for you. Maybe it's something that, you know, you don't think you can just, you know, give up right now. And I also blame Hulk Hogan and Ric Flair for just not letting it go either, they keep coming back and it lets these people get this freaking high hope and this. Thank you, Shawn Michaels, for as much as you can't commentate, thank you for staying retired because they did. They asked him to come back and do a fucking match, and he said absolutely.
And you know
not.
Who they wanted to put him in there with.
Right.
AJ Styles.
Yeah, absolutely.
They would have tore the house down.
They would have, absolutely. I agree. However, he's smart, dude.
Yeah, I was gonna say,
he's smart. He's hurt.
He's worried about his human capital. It's all he's got left.
Yeah.
Exactly, you know? Man. Exactly. You look back and let's not, I mean, as much as, you know, that they're an affiliate link and everything else, it's not unknown facts that there are people with major concussions and major brain injuries associated with this brand.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So, I mean, you can't hide that. You can't.
One of them I'm not allowed to talk about anymore. No.
Damn you. This is a very, very, very strong subject, and I think we hit on it last night, too. There's got to be a certain time when, yes, you got to be like, dude, it's time to let these new people come in. Now the fucked up part is I'm going to completely play the devil's advocate.
On yourself?
On myself, and say, woo, fucking Hardy Boys. We're talking about old fuckers, you know, letting it go and shit like that. And they, the Hardy Boys do absolutely nothing. Let's break it down. Let's not be fanboys.
I saw a pretty good swanton onto the ladder.
No, I do agree. But let's not be fanboys for a couple minutes here. And let's just break it down. Three legitimate tag team. And if you've been kind of keeping up on it, you know, they've been kind of at each other's throats and wanting this match for a while, and it happens, and it's a three-way, and it's going to be interesting, and all of a sudden you find out it's going to be a four-way, and we're all thinking,
and it's the New Day.
It's New Day, and New Day's been involved in that, you know what I'm saying? So you could see where he's coming from with that. Then you turn around, and now you have this freaking,
where are you going with this?
You got the Hardy Boys.
Come on, Shawn Michaels.
You got the Hardy Boys come flying out, and then they take the belts. But they had nothing to do with this prior. You know what I'm saying? Not being fanboys.
The element. But if you're one of those guys. Sorry, I got to get my HBK on. If you take this seriously a little bit, like a lot of fans do, unfortunately, the element of surprise will throw your opponents off. Hence, they win the match. Plus, it's a ladder match. They practically invented
it.
Tag
Absolutely.
Team ladder matches.
I agree with that one.
Consider this. AJ Styles, which I think we talked about a few weeks ago, 37 years old, still, in my opinion, right now, the best in the business. Right up there with John Cena. They can do anything. Matt Hardy is 42. Jeff Hardy, 39. When you consider they've been around 20-plus years, they're still young enough to go. They're not like Ric Flair going out there at 58 years old.
Yeah.
And you just look and go, that's not the guy I grew up with, man.
I think the problem is WWE doesn't do it right with the legends. Like,
sometimes they do and sometimes they don't.
Perfect example of legends done right, okay? Bruno Sammartino comes out of retirement just to get Savage because of what he does to Steamboat.
Oh, yeah.
And he says, I'm coming for you. That's it. And he has him in that bear hug, and there's like 10 people they got to pull off. That's legends done right.
Right.
Yeah. If you just have, like, I kind of agree with you on Goldberg. If you're going to throw Goldberg in just to throw Goldberg in,
I think Goldberg was brought back. He's not broke. That man makes money on top of money.
You know what's funny about the WWE is they think that we're stupid and that we forget about things that happen. Just like Brock Lesnar and The Undertaker, what was it? Was it No Way Out in 2002 or whatever? You know what I mean?
Give or take.
Yeah, exactly. But not a lot of people talk about that match. But that was a fucking phenomenal fucking match.
Sure, sure. One was young and hungry.
Right, exactly.
The other was the locker room leader and could still go.
Was it anything that you just witnessed when Brock took the streak away? No, dude. It was nowhere close to what the hell they were, that death lock that they fucking went through. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
But that was two different beasts. That was a very, very fucking fine-tuned Undertaker.
Sure.
That was a freaking, that was a good freaking fresh, right off the freaking script. Brock Lesnar, nowhere to go, curly-haired, you know, this little Cupid doll motherfucker.
He always did have that baby face.
He did, which, that little fucking Cupid.
Until he went to UFC and got his eyebrows bashed in a couple times and got that Frankenstein forehead, I couldn't take him as a killer.
Yeah.
I mean, you look at him, it looks like he swallowed a Volkswagen the first time you saw him. You're like, good God, what does this kid eat? And he could move. The shooting star press is no joke.
He almost broke his neck.
Yeah, except the one against Angle. I was going to say that. Another WrestleMania moment. God. Another good reason to get the network, by the way.
Absolutely.
At www.lokijabroni.com. You're right. It's two different animals. But I think when they had Goldberg pitching the video game, he made that statement on ESPN. Everybody went, ooh. And somewhere in the tower in Stamford, Connecticut, someone went, oh, no, money.
Absolutely.
And it worked. The best part of it was you have this legit, and I say that word not to demean professional wrestling. We'll talk about it with one of our guests coming up. You have this legit badass, former UFC champion. He dismantles people with his fists, and he gets beaten in a $1.26
right.
by a 55-year-old man.
Right.
But you suspend that disbelief. You're like, oh, I get it now. Where in reality, you know, Goldberg trains Muay Thai. He's got a gym. He's got a school. He's got all these things. Guy's making money top of money.
Look,
he didn't need it.
Look, I am not for a 40-year-old fucking man, the dude is a legit bad ass.
Who's 40? Lesnar. Yes.
I mean, 50. I'm my 55. Bad. 55. For a 55-year-old fucking, I mean, yeah, Lesnar is fucking, he's a freaking nature as it is. I mean, that's when you
get the tail of the tape on these guys, I got to know.
When you look at Goldberg himself, he hasn't lost anything. That's what I'm saying. If you look back in 2000, it was 2000.
I'm sorry, Goldberg is 50.
Okay, yes.
Yeah, Lesnar's 39.
When you look back in 2004 when they first met up, when Goldberg showed up, he looks exactly the same way he did when he showed up yesterday. You know what I'm saying? He hasn't lost anything. He hasn't gained anything. He looks exactly the same. Brock Lesnar obviously has gained a lot. You could tell. You could see it in his face. You could see it in the way with everything that he acted. Real quick, we're going to be heading to a break here momentarily because our first phone guest will be chiming in here in approximately 6-7 minutes. Give you guys a quick rundown. We are going to be part of a meet and greet, a signing, if you will, $20, right down here in Norwich at Pistol Pete's. It's Stonington Ave, I believe,
Route 2. I don't know the address offhand. I'll get it.
I'll hit you guys up when we get back with it. We are going to have, or they're going to have Tony Atlas, Mr. USA there.
WWE Hall of Famer.
WWE and WWF legend, even though we can't say that anymore. But he was, let's be honest. That's where he was from. Well known for lifting Hulk Hogan and literally throwing him like two freaking
like a
chairs.
Rag doll.
Oh, dude. And, of course, our personal buddy, Mr. Blair Bullshark Tugman. He wants a Fat Boy cookie sandwich. When
vanilla
everything's
Chipwich,
all,
I believe.
Yeah, vanilla Chipwich. Yeah, Fat Boy cookie sandwich, as I call it.
So, after the fight, not before the
fight.
Right.
So he is going to be chiming in here in about 5 minutes to let you guys know about this. This is April 9th. It is this Sunday. So if you are actually listening to this on Saturday, it'll be tomorrow. If you're listening to us right now live, it's going to be this Sunday coming up.
That's right.
8 to 10 p.m. All ages welcome. It is a bar. However, they're going to have it set up on the outskirts of it. I think they might even have it inside the main hall area. All ages are welcome. $20 will get you an 8x10. You can get the picture with Mr. Tony Atlas himself and our main man, Mr. Blair Bullshark Tugman, who will be at Mahegan's Sun.
April 21st,
I was going to say, not but freaking 10 more days after that, essentially 11 more days after that. So he's gonna let us know. He's actually calling us on site. He's training right now, so we had to get this little quick little window of opportunity for him to say hi. He's gonna be pretty much hanging up the phone and going right into sparring. So that's pretty fucking badass.
And kicking ass.
We're gonna get him on the phone, guys, and we will be right back.
Blair the Bull Shark Tugman. How are you, sir?
I'm good. How are you guys doing?
We're doing freaking fantastic.
I was going to say the same thing. Because on April 9th, brother, I'm coming for you. What are you going to do when the largest beer belly in the world destroys you?
I'm going to call a cop saying, old man's getting beat on TV.
So we just let everybody know that you'll be, you're obviously at the Sun on the 21st. You are going to be whooping some ass. Which right now you're actually training. You're on spot training right now. You were humble and generous enough to give us a quick 10 minutes here. You will be in the area, Norwich, Pistol Pete's, 8 to 10. Meet and greet with Mr. Blair Bullshark Tugman. You will also be there with Mr. Tony Atlas, Mr. USA himself. So that's gonna be a quite the little experience, man.
Yeah, I'm pretty excited about it. It should be a lot of fun. I know, Pete and those guys had me up for the last fight when we did a signing, and it was a lot of fun. So
that was good times.
Pretty cool people. Got to sign my autograph and had some fun.
Yeah, it was some. There was some pretty. I think there was quite a few eyes kind of stuck on you, man.
Oh yeah,
you had quite the little following afterwards. we had our own like Justin Bieber. We had our own freaking personality. Man. We had to shield
Bieber.
You, man.
You're comparing me to Bieber? Oh god.
See, he said that I didn't see what I was gonna do is start. I was gonna start a bar fight and stand behind you like the kid on the Little Rascals. What?
See, why you gotta bring in the fight, man? Why you gotta bring in the fighting? He just got over the fight
because that's
point.
My buddy, and if I'm gonna get my ass whooped. Oh man! So who's your opponent on the 21st, sir?
The 21st, I'll be fighting Tom English, who's a Bellator vet. He fought on the last card, actually the fight right before mine. He's a tough, scrappy dude. He always comes in great shape, and he brawls. So it should be a good fight.
And I was gonna say, last time you were more technique, you were more wrestling. So how do you, once again, how do you switch this up? Do you go kind of the same game plan? Do you kind of switch it up a little bit? Do you follow that scrappiness with him, or are you sticking more wrestling for counter?
Yeah, I mean, if he really extends himself and throws like loopy punches, which I've seen him do, he kind of like loads up and looks to take my head off.
Right.
I'm probably gonna lower my level and blast double him and take him down and beat the shit out of him. But, I definitely want to showcase some stand up as well, but I don't want to get caught in his game either. So I plan on mixing it up. That's the best answer I can give you.
So how do you train for something like that? Do you have somebody just throw like wild swings at you? Do you have a strategy for something like that?
Yeah, so I've been sparring a lot with the kid Chris Foster, who actually fought Tom on the last card. Chris is a more polished boxer, so it's not as similar, but he's been giving me a good look, and then I have a lot of great training partners.
Nice.
At Ultimate MMA that kind of simulate that, and just a lot of movement with my head and getting the hell out of the way of the big loopy punches and stuff like that, and switching up my stances should help confuse him and make things a little bit harder on him. And then obviously the fear of my takedown.
Yeah.
I would hope he'd be fearful of that, but if not, then better for me.
He's gonna learn real quick,
right?
Yeah.
I'll tell you what. I think you got probably one of the quickest takedowns that I've gotten a chance to witness.
Oh yeah, like absolutely.
You're down, and the next thing you know, you're pummeling. So I mean, kudos to you. You're a quick man, man. You're about as fast as me on the last beer on a Sunday, man. Let me tell you,
nice.
that's only with that last beer on a
now,
Sunday.
Now are they gonna have you on the Spike TV.com bit before the televised card, or are they going to do like we did last time where you're first, you're third, you're last, you're fighting in the parking lot, you're working at Krispy Kreme? They did you dirty last time.
I know.
No, in the contract, you know, they have that I'll be in the prelims prior to the main event. So we should be anywhere between 7 and 9. I can't tell you whether or not what time that'll be, but it is in the contract that we will be prelims, and that way I can get done early and go eat my chipwich.
There you go.
Oh, we got your chipwich. Well, that's what we heard. We heard you upped your game, man. You were like, that's the way to go. So you're getting ready to go out there right now and spar yourself and get a couple swings in right now.
That's correct. Yeah, I'm at the gym right now. I'm actually in the bathroom talking to you guys.
I know. Nice. That's what we love about you, man. You give us any moment that
we love locker room talk around here.
Right.
Real quick, did you happen to catch any of WrestleMania?
I didn't. Me and my buddy were debating on whether or not to get it, and I haven't watched wrestling since I was like in elementary school. But I still had the itch to watch it for some reason.
You always do, man. You always do. It's WrestleMania, absolutely.
But we didn't watch it. But I heard some crazy stuff happened.
It was pretty interesting.
Yeah, there was some crazy. It was
marriage proposals and things like that.
Yes, there was a Total Divas episode on WrestleMania last night. Absolutely.
Oh, I almost forgot. Blair, did you happen to see your leaked training video that Andrew Calandrelli put out there today?
Yeah, I did. I don't know where he got that footage, but I told him not to share that with anybody of me hitting the bag.
That was the funniest stuff I've seen in a long time. I'll have to steal it from Andrew and put it up on our
looking
page.
Looking forward to that, man.
Yeah, he's a good friend, and he's always busting my balls and making me laugh. So he's a good coach.
That's heck awesome. Yeah. That's awesome. All right, man. Well, we're looking forward to seeing you on the 9th. You'll be there. We'll be there. We're blowing this up like sugar bombs everywhere, man. We put it in this one, I guess, we've been putting it in this one gas station and it magically keeps disappearing. So I think
really?
Yeah, Matt says he's pissing off the owner, he keeps putting them in there. So they're everywhere, man. We're looking so forward to this. It's going to be a blast. You get to meet our man, Mr. Blair Bullshark Tugman. He is going to be phenomenal. He's going to be in like just... Trust me, just touch. He's gonna be solid. You're gonna like touch him, and it's gonna be like, wow, yep. Oh, it's like a rock, man.
You know, and I said this, to Blair. I don't know if you heard this when the last time you were down, which was right around the Halloween time. You know, we've got this friendship with Blair. So he comes up and he gives you this monster hug, and your back hurts for a week.
Yeah, I see. I'm smart. I take my Advil beforehand.
Oh, okay, gotcha.
See, I know it's coming. All right, man, go hit that training. Before. Thank you very much for your call. We appreciate you, man. Have a good time. We'll see you Sunday.
Looking forward to the 9th. I'll see you guys.
All right, brother.
Later.
So as Mike said, it's Sunday, April 9th from 8 to 10 at Pistol Pete's, Route 2 in Norwich. As if you are headed from Norwich to Foxwoods, it's right there on the right-hand side. Well, Mike's going to get you an address.
I got it right now because I made the flyer, so.
Okay, it's Blair Tugman. It's Mr. USA, Tony Atlas. It's
You can't miss out, man. This is going to be awesome if you guys are seriously in the Norwich area. It is one of those things that you just can't you don't want to pass up on, man. $20 straight up. Oh, I love that. That is so awesome.
And
Triple H be rolling into WrestleMania live.
There you go. And he changes up. It seems like, and I know you do it for each opponent.
29 Stonington Road, Norwich, Connecticut, 06360. The phone number there is 860-886-0252. It is going on from 8 p.m. to 10 p.m. April 9th. That is this Sunday. $20 will get you a picture and an autograph. 8x10, which means you can actually get next to him, get that picture, and get your autograph.
It might look like this. It might look like something else.
It might look like something else. We'll have Blair Tugman there. I believe Blair is doing his pro bono, as far as I know.
I do not know.
I think he might be doing his for free.
All I know is, like I said, I said it to Blair. Whenever we see him, there's always hugs and handshakes and slaps, and that boy is built.
Absolutely.
It's no joke. On the T-shirt, it says
like,
"Built
like
Tugman
I,
Tough."
Like I wrote here, man. Two warriors, one place, man. This is the place you want to be. Like I said, once again, 29 Stonington Road, Southington. I'm like Southington.
Where is this going to be, HBK?
Southington. I'm like fucking. I can't get out of Hartford today, man. I really can't. It's because I was up till midnight last night, and then I'm drinking these fucking whiskey sours and that freaking Viking blood with you guys. I'm like.
I couldn't even finish that.
Oh, God.
Nor could I. Dude, I handed mine off.
I know. No,
I think I gave you mine. I know. And then
I got Ed's. I got mine. I got yours. I got somebody else's. And then
you might have polished off that whole bottle on your own.
We could probably. I know it's nothing we're associated. We could probably show it out. March 16th, Bret Hart is going to be at Turtle at High School in Thompson.
Yes. March or April.
No, it says March 16th.
March 16th has already passed.
Oh, never mind.
Okay, then.
Wow, I thought that was April.
Yes, I know Alberto Del Rio.
Here's the thing. There's still signs all over the place.
Right.
Oh, wait a minute. It's been on here since March 16th. Hang on.
Right. I think it's April 9th, same day as
Tony. Yeah, April 9th. I'm sorry. April 9th, 2 o'clock.
Yeah. And which happens beforehand, which is why they did this at 8, because he's actually going to go up and see that aspect. But that's, yeah.
Right.
And it's expensive.
Yes, it is.
Oh, yeah.
I tried to contact the promoter to get us in somehow, and that's not happening.
Yeah, Sharpshooter VIP, $100.
Yeah.
No, includes a front row seat, Brett photo op, and item signed by Brett.
Yay. Yeah.
Jesus.
Big fucking
for $100, that autograph better be tattooed on something.
Big fucking deal.
He's walking away.
Shut up.
What the heck?
Fucking Bret Hart.
Bret Hart is a god.
Bret Hart ain't shit. But that's my opinion.
Hello.
Uh-oh. Mike is taking a call, so we'll go from here. When we left off, before we were talking about WrestleMania and Brock Lesnar Goldberg and their ages and whatnot, if you can still go, look at Jericho last night. He can still go. He's 46 years old.
Again, I said this last night. I'll say it again. He needs to shave that shit off his face.
What, that little David Spade thing he's got going on? Not a fan.
It just makes him a little fruity in the pants. That's all I'm going to say. Well, his pants were kind of fruity,
too. I was
going
to say, as if the bedazzled goat pants, which, again, stealing another nickname.
I thought it was Billy.
Yeah, well, that's what the ladies thought it said. Why do his pants say Billy? It doesn't. But look, in this light, it says Billy.
Maybe it said Brady.
Maybe. Ooh. By the way, they found Brady's jersey. We still don't know who killed Biggie and Tupac, but they found that fucking jersey, didn't they?
Oh, I know.
Jackasses.
Oh, I know.
I know who killed Biggie and Tupac.
I do, too.
Me. I killed Biggie and Tupac.
Please.
That's right. Gangsta, yo. Like that.
I don't think you hate music that much.
No, I don't. One or the other, not both.
Speaking of which, sidetrack, the inventor of the Roland TR-808 machine died recently. Japanese fellow. I couldn't not pronounce his name for the life of me.
Hashimoto.
Yeah. But I digress.
What did you think overall as someone who doesn't necessarily keep up with this product?
I know. I'm working on it.
I know.
Overall, I was not impressed.
Really?
I
thought it was better than last year.
I don't remember much of last year.
Well, look at last year. Last year, we got force-fed Roman Reigns. This year, we got force-fed Roman Reigns. Last year, I don't remember if Brock Lesnar had anything to do with
it. You know what? It was probably like lackluster for me also because I don't know a lot of the background on this. Like, you really got to follow the backgrounds and everything leading up to it. I mean, they show clips and stuff. Like the whole John Cena, Nikki Bella thing was stupid.
Yeah, yeah.
Having
to sit through that on television every Tuesday night.
Yeah,
I know
that whole match like pissed me off because, like I said, like it didn't even look like John Cena broke a sweat. So it's like, come on.
You know, it's taken me a long time. I may not like the character John Cena. I understand he busts his ass. There are a few.
I like Cena.
Yeah, there are a few that are better than him. He's just a workhorse. But it's that whole smiley white bread baby face. Hey, apple pie and mom and.
Well, we can't all be Joe Laurinaitis.
Right. He's a badass.
Right.
But
not everybody can be Hawk and Animal.
Right. But I can't take that seriously. So when I say I dislike John Cena, it's not that I don't like what he does in the ring. He is extremely talented. I don't like the character, the gimmick, if you will. I don't like The Miz. That was a throwaway match for me. It really was. I could have cared less if they had scrapped that whole thing and just had John Cena propose to his lady in the middle of the ring. I could have cared less.
Yeah.
The match was garbage.
It was filler.
Mm-hmm. Miz did not.
They did do it early, which was good.
Right. But Miz did not look good at all. Cena. Again, I put him in that same category with AJ Styles. He can do anything, anywhere, at any time, and you're going to enjoy it. You may not like him. You're going to get in the middle of it like I do. I've only been to one in 8 years. you know, let's go Cena, and I'm the guy yelling, Cena sucks. So I'm on that side of the arena, and then they're on this side of the arena. It's fun, but the guy is that good. But to have that guy, the face of the company, seriously, in a meaningless throwaway match while we're getting force-fed Roman Reigns at the end, no, I don't buy it.
It was like he took a vacation day.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's basically what it was. He took a vacation day to propose to his girlfriend.
Yep. I'm a collect a paycheck. I'm going to let HBK and it's also, stammer.
Here's the thing about the marriage proposal things, and knowing that a lot of this is scripted, if not all of it.
Mm-hmm.
But like,
I didn't pay for Total Divas to be on WrestleMania.
Right.
Yeah.
Wasn't that story plot part of Total Divas?
I don't know. I don't see
like because I don't remember that. I watched SmackDown, and mm-hmm. I don't remember him telling the crowd, "Oh, Nikki, you're going into." Why would that be in wrestling? Why, you know what I'm saying? When he came out and he was like, before you went in for your surgery, I had something to tell you, and you told me to be honest, and I said I would tell you when the day came up. Did he do that in wrestling? He didn't.
No idea.
So unless we were watching Total Divas, we wouldn't have known about this stupid story plot.
It's part of the property. It's part of the product.
No, I hear you. It is totally.
And that's also the culture now because there's shows like that for every hockey team and every baseball team and every hard knocks football.
What I hate about some of the stuff they do is with the women wrestlers, they're such outrageous plot lines, if you want to call them that. That really takes away from some of the athleticism some of these women have. Like,
oh yeah,
some of the stuff is pretty impressive. But I think, like, you know, it's definitely not like the '80s where if there was a women's match, they just put two women at it and they just went at each other.
Yeah, exactly. You know?
And all the drama was in the ring,
right?
And I think they get away from that too much. To like, they put all the drama outside.
Man, I tell you though, this woman's crop the last couple years has been absolutely the best I've ever seen.
I'm a fan of Bailey. I admit it.
A hugger.
You know, I'm a hugger.
You know what's funny is I like that gimmick.
Yeah.
Every woman tries that mean, nasty. You know what I'm saying? They get into the ring and they just snarl at each other. And it's like sometimes you just try too hard. And then there's Bailey. She just looks like Punky Brewster. But then she kicks your ass.
Oh, good call.
You know what I'm saying?
Maybe that's why I like her so much.
But no, she is. She's the best thing about her is she's human. Like, she was getting her ass handed to her mm-hmm. last night. You know what I'm saying? She did. She went to the end.
I like the whole shtick of the fangirl.
Yeah. No,
the
absolutely.
Fangirl in the ring thing. I kind of like that.
Unfortunately,
humanizes the
character. I was going to say, they tried it before with Eugene. Remember, they tried that whole fanboy thing.
Well, the difference with that is, and I say this with all due respect to anybody who's got any issue, they had a guy fake that he was mentally challenged.
Yes.
And be the fanboy who did good, whereas Bailey is just Bailey. I'm wondering how much of that character is really her. I'm gonna take a wild guess and say
100%.
Yeah,
she has way too much fun out there.
And
she's
honestly living the dream, as all these girls are. You know, when you see Charlotte out there, she's following Dad's
footsteps.
Charlotte
is phenomenal. Oh, yeah.
You look at her and you know she's putting the work in. You know, she's lifting the weight. She's like,
oh, she's freaking the heritage. I mean, it's right there. You know, it's. I mean, that's why her
like
fucking outfits
she's probably
are
been
fucking
using,
phenomenal.
She's been
dude.
Using
yeah.
Daddy's workout machine since in the womb.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Exactly.
But I think Bailey's doing it right though. I think that's why it's not as tired as Eugene there. Like, she's doing it right.
No, absolutely. I like that.
You know,
I saw
way
that.
She's playing it.
Yeah, exactly. The macho man freaking tight. You don't know what she's going to pull off because it's whatever, I guess.
Oh, yeah.
But if I see her do a leg drop, it's over.
No, that was that big monster woman that does that. That's her.
Naya.
Yeah, that's that.
Ooh, she was. Wow.
She's a monster, dude. She took on freaking Sasha at fast break there, and she lost, but man, she dropped that freaking leg on her, and I thought she killed her, dude.
Oh yeah,
I thought she killed her. She's an animal.
I think she crushed her face.
She is an animal.
Speaking of leg drops, I'm kind of happy WWE is at least showing pictures of Hulk Hogan
now.
Yeah.
So it's baby steps.
Yeah. It
right.
Is. Well, it's
pretty soon
be.
He'll show up.
It is going to be. It is going to be. But I mean, for whatever it is, congratulations, John and Nikki. I guess it's been years coming.
Stephanie, Nicole, Galarza,
Gavin. You know they already had it planned.
You said it. I think you said it best last night. Elizabeth, Will you marry me?
That was the original and still the best.
Like, yeah, please.
Because people wanted that.
Yeah, exactly.
And now you see this, and it's so overblown with the reality show, which I don't think is very much reality.
I got to give Miz credit that the skits that he was doing, making fun of them beforehand, was really fucking entertaining. I thought they were great. But, man, you were a mark, Miz. You are just a straight up mark.
He didn't look good. He didn't perform well. It was almost like Ed said about Cena. It was a day off.
Yeah, it was a vacation day in WWE terms.
Yeah, yeah. No. But that's just it, man. This is a showcase of the immortal. You know what I'm
right.
saying?
And
even John Cena tweets before he freaking goes on, showcase of the immortals. He was just so wrapped up in the fact that I'm wrestling with my girlfriend.
Right.
I honestly think
and like
was,
we were
which
saying,
they did wrong.
Right.
I hate to say that. They did not do it right. There should have been more potential in that match.
What's her name?
If it was
exactly.
Right.
Well, I guess what's her name isn't really a big wrestler, right?
Which one, Mrs. Maurice?
Girl.
She was, I thought,
at one point. Sure. But I don't think she's really been, and you could tell it was just like what I heard, Big Show saying about Shaq.
Yeah.
That he was like, I don't want fat Shaq in the ring with me.
I want Shaq to take this seriously.
Right, exactly.
It's what I do for a living.
And, well, this could be my last WrestleMania, and I got a fat Shaq, and he goes...
Right. Instead, he does that stupid battle royal and gets dumped early.
Yeah, exactly.
What WWE needs to do is another boxing match.
Right, and get Mr. T's
get
ass
Mr.
on
T
the
back.
Phone.
Get Mr. T back there. So, there you go, John. There's your minutes of fame.
Ed and I were talking while you were gone. I want to get your opinion. Cena being the face of the company, this generation's Austin or this generation's Hogan type guy.
Yeah.
Being stuck in the middle of the show in a meaningless girl-boy tag team match seems like a slap in the ass.
I think so.
If you ask me.
You know what's funny, dude, is you look at his face and he was happy.
Yeah.
You know he has already proposed. It was already in the bag. And this was just...
He wanted no. This
including,
is.
This
I think
to
this
include
is.
The
you know what? I think
it.
This is something that he wanted to do. This is something that he's been wanting to do. I think he wanted to freaking. I mean, hell, they do the can't see me together. They do their fucking finishers together. The ref even double counted together.
But only one of them can really do the five knuckle shuffle.
Right. Exactly. Hopefully, it's her.
Right. Just for shits and gigs, Big Show, 45 years old. I'm going to spend a lot of time on some of these ages.
No, I because it's a good thing to bring up because that's what I'm saying. A lot of these younger kids need to seriously be brought in because these guys have been around for a long time, dude.
Right.
Big Show was coming of age when we were watching freaking No. Remember, man, he was giant, freaking No, NWO for crying out loud. When he first came in, you know, he was awful on the microphone.
Captain Insano showed no mercy.
He was awful on the microphone, man.
Some of these young guys, though, like I'm watching them, and some of the moves are pulling off, and it's like, dude, like I look at some of the older guys who didn't really do a lot of crazy aerial
stuff.
But
what they did meant something.
Well, no, here's the thing: like they're doing these more complex things, and it's just like, wow, y'all are gonna be more fucked up than Andre the Giant ever was.
Yeah, keep doing what you're doing.
It's like I was like. Think of Ox. Learn from Ox. You don't want to end up like Ox Baker.
Dead?
Yeah.
Well, he is dead. But right. He was a wreck.
Oh, yeah.
You know, from
I did shows. I did shows with him in New Jersey and around this area.
I met him so many times. He's a nice guy, but...
Ankles were all fucked up. Knees were all fucked up. Hips were all fucked up. His hands, he couldn't close his hand around soda cans for a while there. He was just... You're right. But that was in the day where you drove 500 miles a day to get to a show, and you did a show during the morning, one show a night, two on Sunday, two on Saturday. You know, you might have had 1 week off every 6 months.
The super athletic ones, like the Tito Santanas and Ricky Steamboats, all kind of bowed out at a fairly reasonable age.
Right.
You know,
I think Steamboat was just knocking on 40's door when he retired.
And
Santana was a couple years later,
Like, and Shawn Michaels is the smart one because, you know, keeping it up the way he did, like today, you really think he could perform today had he not retired?
No,
at the same level.
At the same level, no.
Or would he be the Undertaker right now?
Possibly. Shawn being 51 years old.
Yeah.
You saw the stuff he did during his run. He was amazing. There's nothing he wouldn't do or try. He wasn't Hardy Boys crazy, But everything he did meant
he's
something.
Fucking damn
high
close,
impact.
I'll tell you what.
Sure, absolutely.
So, loading on to the next, because we are going to have our guest calling, our second guest calling in here pretty soon.
We're going to call him during the break.
Yep. Loading on to the next, obviously Bray Wyatt and my man Randy Motherfucking Orton. Great match.
Is that his middle name?
Motherfucking Orton.
All right.
Great match, man. Absolutely great match. And while we're at it, let's get this. What is the yard, in your opinion?
The yard?
What is the yard? What does Roman Reigns now have? Because this is what I want to clarify with what I said in my video. You know what I'm saying? But go ahead. In your opinion, what do you consider the yard?
I know that was a catchphrase, the ring. This is my yard. This is where you come and you pay me respect.
Right.
And for what it's worth, again, we talked about disliking a character versus having respect for the work. Never was a big Undertaker fan. Loved the work. I dig the character. Much respect.
Right.
Having said that, that's that whole gimmick.
Like I
of
said, I've always been a Kane fan.
Right.
But Kane's never really, you know, the yard. You know what I'm saying? He's never brought that up. This has been an Undertaker thing.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that being an Undertaker thing, the reason why the Undertaker gets to you is because he doesn't just hit you with, you know, the choke slam or, you know, the power bomb, the last rider, or his, you know, of course, tombstone pile drive. He gets you psychologically.
Mm-hmm.
He gets in your head, and then he pulls off his fucking big execute. That's what he's always been known to do. Who else sounds like that?
Now or then?
Now.
Leaping Lenny Puffo.
Oh, yeah.
Close. Bray Wyatt.
Bray Wyatt. And if you watch the match of him and Randy Orton with the bugs appearing in the ring, which was pretty freaking cool. It was interesting. But imagine you doing that, and all of a sudden you're looking down, there's these fucking bugs. You're like, whoa, man. He's bringing that dark side back to the WWE, and I love that. And like we said last night with the Fireflies, when he's going down there and all you see these freaking lights.
Right, 70,000 people got their gimmick phones up. It was gorgeous.
Amazing. It was so fucking beautiful. It was like, and he made that. You know what I'm saying? In my opinion, he deserves to fucking run the yard.
Oh,
That's his. If you're going to talk about the ring.
2 years ago when you brought me back into this mess, I said that should be the next Undertaker right there.
Oh, absolutely.
And I think last night, they did it wrong. I think it should have been Orton versus Reigns. I think it should have been Bray Wyatt versus Undertaker.
Absolutely. That should have been. And they could have just totally, they could have ran with that for a while. Man.
Sure.
For like safely. Because Wyatt's a great wrestler. He is, at first I didn't
that
want.
That boy got good genes.
I didn't want to like him. I'm not a big fan of those, you know, the Kevin Owens type bodies. You know what I'm saying? Sometimes they're not too athletic, but. Man, Kevin Owens, they're proving me wrong. Mm-hmm. I know they're proving a lot of other people wrong. The things that those guys do are pretty freaking damn impressive.
You know, you know what I would do, like, at this point with Undertaker, like, calling it quits and everything we think? Who knows? Mm. He's done.
In my opinion, if you put your gloves and your outfit in the middle of the ring, that's
what I think he should do.
What Warriors did, they mm-hmm. put their armor down.
What
that
I think
it.
He should do, and if he got together with Bray Wyatt on this, would be a good thing. I think he should start strapping on a black suit, slick hair, assume the role of a funeral home director, and he should manage Bray Wyatt in some kind of phantasm tall man kind of way.
That would be cool.
Could he just,
like the new Paul Bearer would
but
be the
Undertaker.
Could
he just be the Undertaker and be the manager? He is the Dark King or whatever the fuck they've called him for years, Lord of the Dark Side.
Lord of the Dark. Lord of the Darkness.
And now you got the Eater of Worlds.
Yeah.
Which is fantastic.
Yeah, he's...
Put the two of them together, you got money. You really have money. Did anybody see the
pictures? Bring Kane back for a little bit, too.
Yep. Vince, since you're listening,
send us a
check. I won't
charge
you a lot for that.
Yeah. Send us a check. Anybody see
great
the
match.
Pictures? Yeah.
Great
it,
match.
It was, for what it was, Bray Wyatt and Orton was fantastic.
They... once again...
I just want to piggyback your Undertaker point. Did you see the pictures that were on... today that the WWE ring crew left the gear in the ring and worked around it as they tore the ring down, and it wasn't until the last piece was being removed that they took that gear out of the ring.
Wow, that's crazy.
That is crazy. That shows the kind of respect this guy had in the locker room with the crew.
That's what I'm saying, man. Over three decades, and that's just in the WWE.
Yeah,
I remember when he first showed up Saturday morning. Just this guy. I'm like, who the hell is it? Who is this little guy with Undertaker? I'm like, oh,
you got this gimmick, and we talked about it. You know, when we had Brother Love on the show, is this gimmick, this little idea, just turned into this huge, phenomenal icon.
I never thought he'd last.
Really?
I
thought it'd be a couple years.
When he showed up,
welcome.
I thought he would be like another Outback Jack. He's in, he's out. You know, like.
Hey, it's stood the test of time.
But the work he did before that, you knew if you watched the product from WCW, you knew he was good. I didn't know he was that good. It's just the way you program these guys. Yeah.
Look, we might as well just go right into fucking match then.
And we'll touch Goldberg and Lesnar after.
Yeah,
the ladies.
Let me just say, it's the main event.
Which pissed me off because, like you said, the championship should be worth something.
Right. Look, there's been times when it hasn't been, and Undertaker has done that before. I want to say I think it was Edge. Was it against Edge? I think it was one of those matches. It was they didn't have the title.
The title was like Rock.
He had to.
Yeah. Oh, he had to. It was either that or it was going to kill him. Like, he had no fucking choice. And he's married to Beth Phoenix, so he's got to kind of, you know, he's still getting rocked, believe me.
Congratulations on your fake Hall of Fame, Beth.
Yeah, congratulations on
dumbass
sleeping with that.
Right.
Dumbass. Yeah.
You earned it.
You definitely earned it, dude.
Edge did. I don't know about Beth.
I don't know. He's on a couple TV shows. He's pretty good.
Oh, yeah. Nobody's going to take that away from him. He was on Haven. I know he did a bunch of other stuff.
I love Haven.
But, I can't say I was impressed because we all knew Undertaker cannot go anymore. I know that Roman Reigns, I think you said it best, Roman Reigns has the charisma of a flea fart.
Yeah.
And I think he has the personality of a lint ball.
No.
And they're shoving him down our throats week after week after week. It never works. That era of telling us what we should like is over.
No, it's...
They did that with Hulk Hogan, and eventually that got rotten too.
The thing is, like, they don't know what they want to do with him yet. Is he a super good guy? Is he a bad guy? Are they trying to make him a heel? Okay.
The lines are so blurred now.
You got right. You got the yard. What does that mean? What is so does that mean that, like,
you mow it?
Right? So, but no, seriously, does that mean that Roman Reigns is now going to do these gimmick matches, these Inferno matches, these Hell in a Cell matches? You know what I'm saying? Because that's the reason why it was his yard, because he was pretty much the innovator of anything that was pretty much new at that. Inferno match, the fucking Hell in a Cell. I mean,
Buried Alive.
His freaking match with fucking Shawn Michaels. Come on, man.
First ever Hell in a Cell.
Are you serious, man?
The casket match. Where else can we go with this?
Buried Alive. Fucking, like we already said, the Inferno match. The taser. The one where they electrified the fucking fence there, dude.
We got our caller. Let's see if we can't just plug him in. Here we go. Good evening, Gary Wolf. Pitbull number one. How you doing tonight?
Hey, what's happening?
Not a whole lot. We were just talking about Undertaker, Roman Reigns, and I don't think either one of us are overly complimentary of Roman Reigns. Love to know what you think.
Hold on one second.
Sure. We'll talk amongst ourselves for a moment.
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
So you just want to talk about that match?
Oh, no. We're going to hit you up on a couple others, but that's the one we were talking about when you called.
Okay. I thought it was a good match. You got to remember Undertaker. He's been around 25 years, 30 years working for Vince.
Oh, yeah.
I think he went out with respect. That's all he could do.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
Do you have a problem with the company pushing Roman Reigns down everybody's throat the way they have for 2 years?
I think they should stop pushing him and let him get over himself.
Agreed.
Maybe that's the problem. Maybe they're pushing him on these people too hard when they should just let them gravitate to him.
Absolutely. What was it? The Rumble 2 years ago when he won, they booed him out of the building. They had to roll The Rock out to try to give him some shine, yeah. And they still weren't buying it. But I also say to myself, that was Philadelphia, the toughest wrestling city in the world. Philadelphia is not going to like you no matter what you do.
Yeah, and I got to say, I mean, Roman, we still don't know what he's trying to do. I mean, like we were talking before you called, is he trying to be a good guy? Is he trying to be a bad guy? He owns the yard, quote, now. You know, what are they going to do with him? Is he going to be like a gimmick match man now? Like, I'm more confused.
He's got too much talent to be a gimmick match guy. And matter of fact, I think they should make him a heel.
I agree.
Probably get him over more. Just like Stone Cold, just like all the old other guys that they, you know, these guys were heels and getting praised, if you remember correct.
Right.
Oh yeah. If you're a good heel, I mean Razor Ramon, obviously Ravishing Rick Rude.
Yep.
You know, some of these guys get you so you love to hate them so much that you look forward to seeing them every week.
And then at the end of the day, you know, when they retire or they pass away or whatever, you go, "Damn, I miss him. He was awesome. I loved him." And then your buddies go, "Well, aren't you the guy that took the sign to name the town that said, fuck Rick Rude?" You know, that's the kind of guy, and I get where Gary's going with this, that's the kind of guy you eventually learn to love. Don't tell me to love him. As we said, the days of shoving Hogan down your throat are over. Cena had to go heel when they tried to shove him down our throats, and look where he is now.
Yeah, that's true. So worst match of the night last night for you, Pitbull. Lay it on us.
I'm going to be honest with you. I thought the whole show was great, what I saw of it. I think Shane McMahon and AJ Styles opening up so fucking hot.
That was awesome, right?
Awesome.
That was awesome. AJ looked
Because I'd be
AJ
in the back of the locker room. I'd be in the back of the locker room just sitting there smiling, saying, who is going to follow that?
Precisely.
Yeah, exactly.
So I love that match. I said it before. I said it today. Anything AJ touches is gold.
Yeah,
anything.
I just felt like, you know, they didn't know what to do with him this year. And, man, it was just – they just kind of threw him in. And I was like, man, they just so much they could have done with him this year. I felt like it was rough, man. It was rough for our man AJ.
But, even Chris Jericho's match was good. I mean,
a lot of the
matches were really, really good.
Mm-hmm.
You know, except for the gimmick match with Cena and his girl.
Yeah, which we tore up.
I mean, the girls didn't even really do anything.
No.
I mean, it was just more or less Cena versus Miz.
And even then, Miz did not look like he was on his game
Miz
at all.
Miz looked like he was, like, sick or something. I don't know. He did not look into it at all. Not one bit.
I mean, would you be happy, I mean, knowing that you're going into the ring?
No, absolutely.
And this is the gimmick you're doing, and this is the match you're having, and this is the angle that's going to be about it. That match wasn't for WrestleMania. That match was for Total Divas.
Right. Oh, absolutely. No, that's exactly what I said, too. I was like, if you didn't watch Total Divas, you had no idea where they were coming with that angle because they didn't give you that story on Raw or on SmackDown. I didn't know anything about Bella going in for surgery, and Cena was like, I'm going to have a conversation with you, and I'm going to reveal what we talked about when the time is right. WrestleMania, the time is right. I was like, where is this even coming from? Like, what the
heck? It's a work.
Yeah.
Number one, I loved what Miz and his girl did with Cena.
That was awesome. That was awesome.
That was fucking awesome. You know, the rules of the house. I mean, come on, man. That was fucking great.
It was genius.
If you don't think it was, I mean, just like Bray Wyatt and you know, Randy Orton with their gimmick they did. That's back old ECW gimmicks, man, and old ECW montages and stuff if you looked at it and you remember.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
No, we were talking about that a couple weeks ago with the when you went to SmackDown at Uncasville, how those little mini films were hilarious. You have broken rule 179.
Yeah, exactly. Don't try to further your career on my time.
That's him. That's absolutely right. I mean, come on, man. You can't get more shooter than that.
Right.
That is perfect.
So what did you think of Lesnar versus Goldberg last night?
I thought it was a good match for two big guys. I mean, like I said, what are they going to do? How are they going to follow matches before them?
Yeah. Yeah, because they were awesome.
Like I said, I'd be in the back, I'd be screaming and be like, how? Your match? How are you going to follow that? Because that's how we used to do it in ECW. Absolutely. We all tried to outdo the other person before they went out there.
Heck yes, and now that's what made those ECW shows phenomenal.
Oh, absolutely. I agree. I agree. But that's what I was going to say. Everything came out fire. I mean, the first 2 hours of WrestleMania was fire. Hardy Boys coming out. What'd you think of that, Pitbull?
They needed the Hardy Boys in that match.
Yeah. Yes, they did.
I mean, 100%. I mean, you got to realize, I like Gallows.
Mm-hmm.
I like Anderson. I think they're a great tag team. They're not ladder guys. They're not gimmick guys.
Right.
I never seen them do a ladder match. I never seen Kaz and his partner do a ladder match.
Yeah, and so Kaz is a big dude, man. I mean,
I can't see him climbing a ladder.
Me either. I was thinking the same thing. I was like, dude, this guy's gonna. It's like a giraffe trying to climb a ladder. You just don't see.
I mean,
it.
If anything, they should have just made him the ladder, and they should have climbed him. I mean, he's that big.
Really?
But they needed the Hardy Boys to make that match. I didn't think that was gonna happen. Don't get me wrong, but when they did announce them coming out, I that's when I knew right there and then that, yeah, they needed them there.
I squealed like a schoolgirl.
I think we all did.
I squealed like a schoolgirl. I ain't gonna lie.
I think poor Rachel was gonna jump through the floor.
Yeah,
and she was jumping up and down like a kid who just.
She was worse than all of us.
But it was great, and when you consider that, you know, Matt and Jeff aren't all that old, and I don't say old to be rude. I mean, hell, I'm 45. They're younger than I am, and they can still go.
Yeah. Speaking of going, Neville Aries, what did you think of that one, Pipple?
I didn't see that match. I don't know what happened. I was watching WrestleMania. I never saw the match.
Unfortunately, it was one of the matches that they did during the pre part of it. It was freaking phenomenal. I thought it was awesome.
I was predicting that was going to probably one of the best matches that night. I'll be honest with you, if I didn't see it.
It was awesome.
Yeah, those guys tore into each other. I mean, it was everything that. I mean, the promos, you watch that promo and everything it went through. And I obviously, when I went to the SmackDown, they showed, he came in and, you know, Aries came back from that injury and all that other thing from his broken eye socket or whatever it was. But, man, what a freaking great match those two threw on. That was absolutely fantastic.
I've never seen a bad Austin Aries match ever.
I got to agree with you on that one. He's impressive. He is impressive. I think they thinned down, they toned up, and they did this 201. The 205 gimmick. And at first, I wasn't too big on it. But, I mean, obviously, if you have that many cruiserweights, go with it, man.
No, I mean, that's what to do. I mean, I personally would never have brought Neville down to the 205. I would have kept him up to the main roster. But
right.
I guess they had a plan for him. I mean, he was that good that how can he not have a belt?
Oh, yeah. The stuff he did with Stardust a year ago was awesome.
Oh, my God.
Awesome.
That was insane. That really was insane.
You can't go wrong with that guy. You really cannot.
No, he's a worker.
He's extremely talented. Extremely. I mean, as far as high spots, I mean, the guy blows people away. I mean, once he learns the trade and how to tell a story, which Aries probably helped him do.
I think so. I think this,
you know, because being a heel, like I said, you know the Lord by you. Usually heels call matches. He proved himself. I've seen Aries wrestle before. I have no doubt in my mind it would have been I knew it was going to be a great match. I just, like I said, I'm sorry I missed it.
I'm sure you can find it out there either on the network or probably someone's got it on YouTube.
At this point, I wouldn't doubt it. Probably about 15 different people.
Yeah, YouTube's probably getting flooded right now.
Yeah, and within a week, it'll be gone. Copyright this.
Woman's title, Bayley taking it again. What did you think?
The women's title. I personally thought Charlotte Flair should have won that match. I personally don't. I mean, Bayley is, to me, she looks like a child.
Punky Brewster, right?
It's just. I mean,
haters gonna
I
hate.
Know she worked. I know she worked hard in NXT, but they should not have brought her up so soon. Because I mean, where is she going to go from now? I mean, they already put the belt on her. She's only going downhill. She's not going to go back up. Flair's daughter is the business.
We all know that, though. We all know that. I think everybody at this point knows that. They're just letting a couple people have it, and who knows? Maybe they're trying to give her the 13 time sooner than anybody expects, you know, so she can start throwing that gimmick around.
I don't care. I'm still a hugger.
I mean, hey, she may drop the belt tonight. Who knows?
Exactly.
You know what I mean? So you know how it is. They'll do a WrestleMania, and the Monday night comes around, and belts get flipped back right over. I mean, immediately. So
always. That's how it usually works, man. Intercontinental. What'd you think of
Ambrose and Corbin?
The Lone Wolf main versus the Maniac Fringe.
The guy who changed my oil last week, Dean Ambrose.
I love Dean Ambrose. I've known Dean Ambrose. I met him in Philly a long time ago, and you know I've seen him work. The Baron Corbin, not that much of a fan. I didn't see the match. I wish I did. They must have showed that with all. I mean, I watched the Mania, and I didn't see that match. Was that on before?
It was another kickoff match.
It was right before. Right before freaking AJ Styles.
How did that end up?
I don't remember that match.
Ambrose won that match by pinfall.
Or did I just come in on AJ Styles?
You came in right as the show was starting.
I didn't see any of the pre-show.
Then you missed it.
All right.
That's pretty cut and dry right there.
Yeah.
I was actually bummed out because I wanted to see Dean's match. So, you know what I mean? So,
I catch a lot of crap. I'm going to catch crap. I don't think – I like Dean Ambrose's work, let's be honest. The guy can go. And if you can go, you deserve your spot. He doesn't look – and I don't say you have to have golden jackets and sparkles and gimmicks, but he just doesn't look like a star. He looks like the guy that loads feed down at the local feed store. The Pitbulls
What's the difference between him and Pillman? What's the difference between him and Sandman?
It's the crazy gimmick. It's that crazy
right.
gimmick.
No. And Mike brought that up earlier. I get it. I'm okay with that. I just, for me, I don't get the whole Dean Ambrose thing. I got the Sandman. I got Pillman. I don't know what it is. I just can't. I can't get behind Dean Ambrose as good as he is.
I like how he's constantly looking like he's got a Starburst in his mouth.
He was a hardcore wrestler. You know, now he's working for a company that, you know, they don't even have the Attitude Era anymore. I think Shane's trying to bring it back. Don't get me wrong. You know, but I mean, I think Dean's doing great. I mean, even the guy that was with Wyatt, with the black beard, what's his name? Slip of my mind.
Luke Harper.
Yes.
Luke Harper worked with Dean Ambrose for many, 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 many years, doing the hardcore scene.
See, I dig Luke
Harper. And these guys turned it around where now they're actually working. Instead of getting their head chopped open with a fucking hacksaw and
exactly.
light tubes and exactly. you know, bullshit like that. You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely. I don't dislike Dean Ambrose. I just don't see – I don't find the appeal. I don't. I everybody I know loves the Dean Ambrose. I don't get it. And maybe that's just me. Maybe I'm wrong.
I respect him. I'm not a big fan of him. I was kind of hoping Corbin was going to take that one myself.
Yeah.
Excuse me. But, I mean, it was a great match. I mean, they performed very well together. I mean, Corbin is like, God, like almost twice the dude's size, you know? So it was kind of cool seeing that aspect of it.
He moves like a guy who is, you know, 5'10", 215, 220 pounds, and the kid's pushing 300 pounds.
When he was, when I went to go see that SmackDown, they were doing that when Randy Orton would throw him out of the ring, and he'd do that running around the freaking ring. And dude, he is back in the ring like that. I will give him that, man. He is quick.
Well, he played football, didn't he? Play pro football?
Yes, absolutely.
Well, there you go. I mean, come on, that's why he's fast as hell.
Yeah,
there you go.
From the words.
So you give this show overall a really good rating.
I'm going to be honest with you. I haven't seen a WrestleMania in a while, and I decided to watch this one because I thought this was going to be a good show, and it did. Like I said, it started hot as hell.
Oh, God, it was
fire. And they brought it up to the top. I mean, they got it up to where it was, and then they dropped it down real low when they brought out the singers, the sing, and all that crap.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And then Triple H brought it right back up with that great entrance he did.
Ooh.
You know, and I mean, that's what wrestling's about. It's a big, big, big roller coaster. It's ups and downs.
Right.
Right. No, so absolutely. Think, you know, absolutely.
By bringing in the girls' match, and you know, that brought it back down again, and then they brought it back up again. Then when they had the Cena match with Miz, they brought it back down and
that
pretty much flattened the people out.
Yeah.
You know, they're you sleeping. Get the Goldberg and, you know, the Goldberg and the Brock Lesnar match in. I mean, what are you going to expect them guys to do? You know what I'm saying? You're not going to expect them to do all these high spots. What they did was what they do. Suplex, suplex, suplex.
Right.
And that's what it turned out to be. I thought it was a good match. Brock deserves the belt. He don't need to have it, but I mean, he does have it. Now that's depending on whether or not, I don't know if Goldberg is sticking around or not. You understand what I'm saying?
Well, right. I heard he was contracted for 6 months, right? So, I think that was, obviously the beginning of the year. So he's got to be until June. Don't forget, if you bought the WWE Network yesterday or within the last week, you have it all the way for like next three pay-per-views, right?
I think so.
So it's like you're getting 3 months for free. So I'm thinking they're going to obviously keep this little Goldberg thing going on just a little bit longer.
Back and forth, you think?
Yeah. Right, exactly. I think they got a couple more months with Goldberg. So he's not going anywhere right now. It was a clean match. There's no questions asked. There's no other, you know, there's no weird shit going on. It happened, you know, so.
Well, if you notice also, you know, by the time the match was done, neither one of them looked weak. They both looked strong.
Yes.
You know, so it didn't hurt. Even though Goldberg lost, it didn't matter.
Right.
Oh, absolutely not. Absolutely not. I get what you're saying there. After this 6 months, which, like we said, he's signed for 6 months. What do they do with the character?
And that's what Goldberg you're talking about?
Yeah. Obviously, Lesnar is, if you're giving him the belt, you're making a statement right now that, you know, Lesnar is going to be carrying this into the future. You just have The Undertaker lay down his gloves. You know, there's all this shit going around. You need faces to carry this new, like you said, this hopefully attitude, this grittier franchise forward.
Well, to be honest with you, Goldberg's still on for June.
That's
I'm
what
sure
we're thinking.
He's going to get
that
strap again.
Oh yeah, you know yeah, saying? Yeah. That's going to play absolutely.
Yeah, I mean they're going to use Goldberg until, you know, absolutely positively until he's done.
Right.
And that means exactly what is that he'll get the strap again, and him and Brock have a future. I mean, what are they, 1-1 now?
No, it's Goldberg's 2-1.
2-1,
point.
Yeah.
Okay, so they have there's definitely going to be a third match, absolutely.
Oh, yeah.
You know, I'm sitting back looking at TMZ, and all they're showing is Cena and Nikki Bella with this stupid ring gimmick that they did.
Oh, yeah.
And, you know what I mean? I mean, come on, man. All it was, you know, he's giving her a fucking fugazi and trying to push it, you know, just to promote the damn television show.
Oh, I definitely feel on there, man. I was pretty upset myself when I saw what they were doing.
Say it again. It's the product. It is. They got to sell the product.
I get what they're doing, but man, for some of us that don't want it.
You know, Vince McMahon, he's a businessman. I mean, the company's business.
Obviously.
So, I mean, now they got the Divas. They get great ratings, I'm sure. I mean, for them to be on this long, I'm sure they're getting good ratings.
Let's not forget, too, it's a publicly shared corporation now, and they got to make as much money as possible.
Let's look at the shows that those ones are up against, like the Housewives. Ones and Housewives are like New York. That's what the Total Divas is up against. This one. So I mean, if you get to watch something like that or the Housewives of New York, I think maybe the Divas might be a little bit more exciting because it's around wrestling. You know what I'm saying? So that in itself makes that show just a little bit more interesting than the Housewives of New York or the Housewives of Orange County or whatever.
I'd rather have a raging, burning ass rash than watch either of those shows.
Maybe if they did another show.
I agree. But look, also, you probably agree with me with this. I mean, Total Divas totally broke kayfabe.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Yes.
I mean, come on, man. When I grew up in the business, I mean, heels were in one locker room, baby faces were in another. We didn't even talk to each other. Yeah, we had a referee, you know, telling us what we're going to do and how we're going to do it and vice versa. I mean, come on. I mean, kayfabe is gone.
Yes.
You know, which now, you know, it's harder for them to do angles and do storylines. I mean, at least... You know, you got some storylines from that WrestleMania that they've been doing for 8 months.
Yep.
Which is unheard of for Vince McMahon nowadays.
Right, because everything's been 3 months done or even sometimes a month done. Let's get to the next show and then we'll worry about it later. I completely agree with that.
Yeah.
I miss the good stuff used to last a year years.
I was going to say, sometimes, a whole fucking season.
Like the Hogan Roddy Piper thing was years.
Hogan Piper, Hogan Sting, McMahon Austin. Christ, there's just a million of them.
Piper, Snuka. Yes.
Undertaker, everyone.
Don Morocco. I mean, come on, guys.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Big John Studd and Andre the Giant was one.
Oh, that went on for couple of years.
They had like three or four body slam matches.
Right. Fucking, what was it? Freaking Ricky the Dragon Steamboat there and...
Randy Savage.
That lasted a year because that's when the Bruno San Martino thing came out.
That was the best. Yeah, that was the fucking.
In my opinion, that's the best match ever.
Because that brought out the best in all the wrestlers. Like, oh my God, Savage hurt Steamboat. Like, everybody wants a piece of Savage. Yeah. It was fucking great. that was the best one.
No, they did a great job with that. That's when they were.
Like, George Animal Steel. Going after Savage.
The fucking baddest man. In the business, the Nature Boy. I mean, the Nature Boy versus Savage, the Nature Boy versus Steamboat. I mean, come on. Yeah. You can't follow match.
No, absolutely not. And he was the dirtiest player of the game.
Funny, Gary, that you bring up Flair, because Flair Sting went on again, off again for 10 years.
Yeah.
Oh, you know what? British Bulldogs and Beefcake and Valentine used to be one.
Another one that went like a year and a half.
No, a couple of years. Two WrestleManias worth,
Heart Foundation.
I think.
Give or take,
The Pitbull and the Bulldog did a fucking 6 months together.
Nice. Awesome.
You know, in Australia and New Zealand, all over the, you know, as far as them countries. I mean, we did that with them, and people loved it.
That's funny.
You know, we went to the American Pitbulls. They kept their gimmick, the British Bulldogs, and it was over.
If there was anything you could change about last night, what would it be?
Like I said, I wouldn't have had Bailey go over.
It wouldn't be 80 bucks.
Uso's wife ended up winning. She should have won that match. I think that, what's the one that had the belt? What was her name?
Bailey?
Bailey kept it.
No, SmackDown Girls.
Oh, Alexa Bliss.
Oh, yes, Bliss.
I think Alexa Bliss is like a Bailey, not ready. I thought they brought her up too soon. She looks like a little girl. I mean, they can't even... the girl with the red hair...
Becky.
I mean, Becky Lynch, one hell of a fucking worker.
Oh, yeah, she
I
is.
Mean, you cannot deny that, you know. I eventually think they should be doing Natty, you know, using her Heart Foundation gimmick with Flair's daughter. So you have the Flairs versus the Hearts.
Ooh,
I mean,
yes.
That would be, and that could go on. That could go on for a year until WrestleMania.
Wow.
I mean, that's what I would do if I was booking that. Nice. Me personally, but, you know, you got legacies out there. Like they said, you know, you got guys now, you got IRS's kids in there. You got Bob Orton's son in there, you know, the Viper. I mean, you could do family angles versus other families that have been in the business so long.
Yeah.
Now, I was hoping and praying that Miss Abigail would be popping out at WrestleMania, and they didn't do it.
I was wondering the same thing. How are they going to resolve the Sister Abigail thing?
They have her. It's just a matter of when they're going to bring her out.
Do they have someone in mind for the role?
I'm sure they do. I'm sure they
I didn't know if you had some inside stuff you wanted to share with us.
Come on now.
I know. Old school kayfabe, man. Come on.
They wouldn't have been. See, if they mentioned Sister Abigail, they've already found her sitting there in the NXT school, and it's just a matter of when they're going to bring her out because she's going to get over like Nia Jax.
Mm-hmm.
You know, come on, a beast.
Woman, she's awesome.
You actually think Bayley should have a belt over her? I mean, you're talking about little kids compared to a woman.
No, it's funny that you bring that up because I was thinking that when they were, they literally, three of them went right after her to get her out. Like, that's, they all went after her. Yeah.
Well, that's a sensible thing to do. That's the smartest thing to do.
The old Andre the Giant in a battle royal, the bell rings, but yeah, and 19 this, guys go after Andre.
If she was single-handedly put up against one of these people with a belt, how are they going to beat her?
They don't.
Really?
I mean, obviously, Sasha Banks beat her, you know, the last time, and it was out of luck. But, I mean, how are you going to beat that? She's awesome. She's gnarly, man.
You
she's
don't beat
super
her.
Gnarly.
That's what they should do. Build her like a monster, like they're doing with Strowman, mm-hmm. who is not only a monster, but he can go.
Absolutely.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, yes.
He can work his ass off. And he was in Hollywood doing movies before he became into business, you know?
Wow.
They just recently started letting him talk, and his promos are pretty damn good.
Yeah, they are. He's actually pretty badass. I didn't dig Ryback when he was here. I think Strowman does Ryback better than Ryback.
Yeah.
Something's up with that, with Ryback and them. I don't understand what happened with that.
You got a guy out there.
He can work. And they push. They tried to push him and push him and push him and push him and push him. And he finally started getting over. And then they get rid of him. It didn't make any sense to me.
Right.
Yeah,
and that was another guy at the beginning. They tried to push him down your throat, and they took their foot off the gas. And wait a minute, let's see what he can do. When he got himself over, people loved this guy, and now he's gone.
It just doesn't make sense.
Never does, man.
They probably piss people off. That's what happens. Sleeping with the wrong person.
Oh, Lord.
I mean, like I said, you know, with Kevin Owens and Chris Jericho, I mean, you know, Jericho's going on tour, so that makes sense.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely. But see, and again, okay, I know we spoke about the internet in our very first interview. Does it help? Does it hurt? But knowing that Jericho is going to go off for 6 months and tour with his band, yeah, you get why Kevin Owens goes over Chris Jericho.
Well, in our business, if you're an older guy, like, I would have no problem putting somebody over because my time has already been here and done. It's time to move on to the younger guys, which are there now. Like, Sami Zayn, and you got all these young guys there. You know what I'm saying? So, I mean, the older guys have to give them that rub. You know, it's time to pass the torch.
Absolutely. And to be honest, I've watched Undertaker do it for years. I've watched Jericho do it. Jericho jobbed out to, what's the dancing guy's name at WrestleMania a few years ago? Fandango.
Oh,
Jericho laid down for Cena in his first 3-4 weeks in the company. Jericho's, and I put Undertaker in that too, has never had a problem laying down and doing the right thing to give a little shine to the new up and comer, but at the same time, he's just not, they're not shoving it down your throat. Wow, this guy beat Jericho. He must be pretty good. I'm going to watch this guy.
Well, that's the right, that is the right thing to do in the business. That's what the old timers back in the day, I mean, like I said, they're my, the guys that brought me up in the business, their kids are in the business now. Mm-hmm. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah, so, absolutely.
You know, they taught us, you know, hey, they were putting me and my partner over, you know, and we were like wondering why, you know, why is Terry Funk and Stan Hansen putting me and my partner over? I don't understand that. Well, because it's their time to do that. That's what it's time to do.
Right, and you can't kill the swamp. You have to have something that's going to grow when you go. If you're Terry Funk, you're Stan Hansen, there has to be a new crop. You're not going to be immortal forever. I know that's a dumb word to use in this business because everybody gets old, everybody diminishes, and everybody goes away. But by helping the young guys and giving them a little shine, you're making sure that the business is
better
healthy.
Better to go out on top.
Right. And you're making sure the business is healthy going forward. Nobody wants to
absolutely
see.
Absolutely.
Right. Nobody.
I mean, Shane put AJ over, which is rightfully so. He should.
Right.
That's smart for business.
I mean,
just like Triple H put over
Seth.
He put Seth over. That's good for business. I mean, that's just business, man.
And no matter how much you love the guys from your youth, I certainly don't want to see Don Morocco get in a ring now. I don't want to see Don Mattingly put on the uniform and play first base for the Yankees anymore. But he made it possible for everybody that came after him.
That's what their job. That's what it's supposed to be. That's how the business is supposed to be.
Right, but sometimes
it doesn't happen. A lot of guys get fired because their ego is too big. You know, and it's like, hey, you got to put him over tonight. I don't want to. What do you mean you don't want to? That's what your job is. Right. Do it.
What is the one I it's rumored that one time Hulk Hogan said nobody would believe that Jeff Jarrett could beat Hulk Hogan. But like you said, it's all a work. You're entertaining the people. Give the people what they want to see.
I always say that. I always say I'm giving the people what they want. And the guys will look at me and be like, what are you talking about? And laugh. And I'm like, I'm going to give them what they paid for. They're going to get what they want. You know, I mean, sometimes, and like I said, when I was growing up in the business, the old timers would tell me, you know, if they want it bad enough, don't give it to them. Let them wait and mm-hmm. wait and wait. And eventually they'll pay to see what they want to see.
Right. I remember being, I don't know how long it went. It was good. It was almost a good year between Douglas and Bigelow leading up to November to Remember in 97, 98. I think you guys were there. Anthony was there doing the TV title.
Yeah, I was out with my broken neck at that point.
Right. But all those matches had a nice long lead in. They swapped their wins, and that was the blow off that night. Nobody walked away unhappy.
If you watch the angle me and Shane did, they didn't want to do that angle at first because they didn't know if I was going to be ready.
Right.
I knew I was going to be ready. The doctor told me I was going to be ready. I took an extra 2 months. Shane didn't even want to cut the promo because he felt so weird. I was like, cut him. Let's do it. This is the best angle. And when Rick Rude brought me back, and I have to say this about the Rick Rude family, his son is going to be the next superstar.
Oh, yeah. We were saying that last night. As a strapping young boy, and he could talk.
Oh, absolutely.
He's going to
have the jaw, baby.
Once that baby fat comes off that boy, he's going to be a monster.
Will he have the 8-pack?
Oh, probably. Good genes. That boy got good genes.
Good genes.
But, yeah, we were saying that last night watching the Hall of Fame highlights. Like, that kid needs to get in the business tomorrow.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, he's got it. I was very, very close with Rick, and let me tell you, he's got it. It's him. He sounds just like him. He's as tall, maybe taller than he is.
He looked taller than Rick was in his prime.
He looked pretty good.
Oh, yeah.
Even with the Tom Selleck poof.
Was Rick Rude that tall, though? Like
6'2", 6'3",
yeah,
I think.
He's a big
was
dude.
He over
6'2"?
Gary, yeah. You worked with him. How tall is Rude?
Rude?
Yeah.
He's over 6'2", okay. Probably.
Oh. I thought he was one of the shorter wrestlers.
Yeah, he was at my – him and Steve Austin, they were always at my house when they were working for ECW. for weeks at a time, we would always have fun with them guys. Most of the guys that came into ECW would hang out with the Pitbulls in Philadelphia because they knew they were going to have a good time.
And we always have a good time when you call into our show. We've got to tell you that off the bat.
Fuck yeah.
You are the man, dude.
Thank you, brother.
Well, I definitely want to thank you for your WrestleMania insight, and we will talk to you again, I don't know how long from now. We talk about wrestling all the time. We may give you a call when you least expect it just to get your opinion on something.
Yeah, I want to plug something real quick.
Sure.
I was supposed to be at WrestleMania doing signings, and there's a kid named Sean Mullen who thinks he's a promoter. And I turned down four or five different promoters just to stick with this kid because I figured I'd give the kid a chance. What does he do? He screws me.
Ooh.
Oh, that's not good.
So this is an anti-plug.
Yeah. So anybody doing business with him, I advise you not to.
Wow.
Wow, that's awful. Why would...
Is this the same guy I saw Rob Feinstein, mutual friend of ours, complaining about recently doing business with?
Maybe. It's possible. I wouldn't doubt. He was living in Florida. He moved to Michigan. Now he's back in Florida, supposedly. But, you know, like I said, you know, he had a hotel for me. He had a table for me. You know, everything was set up. And, you know, he just screwed me. Totally screwed me. So I would, anybody out there, young guys, older guys, you can't trust these people. They're just wannabe promoters.
Yeah.
Wannabe promoters.
If
the
you're not,
worst.
Yeah, if you're not going to do good business, don't do business at all.
No. No. Don't waste people's time. Don't let them lose money. You know, does he think I have no bills to pay? You know?
Yeah,
also, I noticed that TNA's back in action. I heard he got rid of Dixie Carter.
Yes. Yeah. And we just had Bruce Pritchard here a few weeks ago. He just got signed again as creative.
Awesome. Pritchard is an awesome guy. I knew Pritchard when I was 18 years old working for Vince. We weren't too buddy-buddy back then, but now, you know, we went on the road together a couple of months ago, did a couple of shows in New York together, and to be honest with you, I love Bruce. Bruce is cool as hell. We got along great, and they need Bruce there if they want to make that company good. I'm going to be perfectly honest with you.
He's got damn good ideas. Still, to this day, got some damn good ideas.
Absolutely.
Oh, yeah, definitely. He's an asset, put it that way.
Absolutely. Gary Pitbull, number one wolf, thank you again for your time. We will be in contact soon.
All right, bro. You guys have a good day and have a good night and enjoy watching Raw, folks. It should be a good night.
Absolutely. Excellent. Good night, bro.
Mate.
All right. I got too many things going on this here phone.
I know, right? Yeah, I was double hearing that stuff coming back. So we didn't really click on it too much. I mean, obviously we trashed his entrance. Pitbull seemed to like it.
Yeah.
Well,
know,
don't we feel like fucking assholes?
I bet you he just likes the trike. That's what it is.
Maybe.
He probably got one. He probably got a custom-made trike.
I think the bar is just set high.
I deferred.
It's like you expect more.
I defer to Gary. I call him maybe every 2 months or so. I'll see something on television. I'll give him a call. Say, Gary, what'd you think? Oh, brother, I love this, and I hated this, and they should have done this better. When it comes to even WrestleMania, which I'm allowed to have my opinion. You're allowed to have your opinion. Everybody's allowed to think what they want to think. I defer to him on all those things. I don't like Dean Ambrose. Here's why Dean Ambrose is good, says Gary, and he throws it at you. Okay, I take a look at it a little differently. We've done it. Just look at something from a different perspective, and to have a guy who busted his ass in the business for 25 years tell me that versus some jackass on the internet going, you should like Dean Ambrose. He's so awesome. No, he's not. But if Gary says it, he's walked the walk.
You need to stay off that Chris Benoit site, goddammit.
I don't play with it anymore.
It's not going to help you.
I don't play with it anymore.
So what do we think of the match? Like I said, we made fun of the intro. Let's break down the match.
I had less of a problem with the match than I thought I would.
I'll buy that.
Hunter, for what, again, 46-year-old guy.
Good way to put it.
What's he doing? 3 to 4 spots a year now? He's basically the Undertaker, now that The Undertaker's gone. Triple H is that guy who's going to do 3-4 spots a year.
Yeah, I think they did say something like that. That was a stat. He is right now the only person that rivals The Undertaker for most WrestleMania appearances, which is why he's still doing it,
yeah.
I imagine. Obviously, this is Undertaker's last one, so you're thinking, man, oh, damn, fucking Triple H.
Taker's 52, Triple H is 47, 46, somewhere in that neighborhood.
Yeah, but he wasn't in, like, the earlier WrestleManias, you know what I'm saying? So
no, I think Undertaker had 2 or 3 on him.
Right, exactly. So
before, yeah.
So
I got no problem with the match. I really didn't. I thought Hunter worked to his strengths. I thought he made Seth Rollins look like $1 million. What I wanted to see and didn't see, and again, let's go back to that little non-sanctioned match gimmick that they had going on with this. Where was Samoa Joe during all this?
Triple H's
hired assassin. Where was Joe?
I was wondering the same thing.
Because that was ready-made right there. All they had to do was have Joe come out, cause some chicanery. You got Rollins and Joe for the next 6 months.
Yeah, exactly.
And Samoa Joe, another older guy in wrestling terms, I think he's knocking on 40's door, can still go. I mean, I know people look at age and go, oh, that guy's in his 40s. He can't go. Fuck you.
Yeah.
Chris Jericho can go every fucking night.
I think it's the people like in their 20s that say that shit, though.
Yeah. I know. Look, my guys growing up are Bob Backlund, Ric Flair. And I remember reading in a magazine, standing at the mall, that old news rack place. You remember that little joint right there off to the side where Dairy Queen is now?
Yes.
Flipping through the magazine, it said, Ric Flair just celebrated his 40th birthday. And I'm thinking, motherfucker, that dude's old. And then 2 nights later, I'm watching a pay-per-view, and he's out there doing his thing like he's 22. It's a number, man.
No, it really – well, it depends on how bad
– depends on the number.
Depends on the number, and well, it depends on the number of injuries.
Look at it this way.
What is it Indiana Jones says? It's not the age, it's the mileage?
Yeah.
But when you look at Ric Flair, say, in 98 or Ric Flair in 2002, he could still go – but the engine started to sputter. And
right.
Then when it finally came down to he's going to retire in 2008, was it, against Shawn Michaels? He put on the match of his life. And, of course, he was with Shawn Michaels. It's hard to have a bad match with Shawn fucking Michaels.
I agree.
My God, I watched that match 30-plus minutes, and by the end, Flair didn't take a back step. He looked good for 56, 57, however old he was at the time. Looked phenomenal. But he can't do that today, 10 years after the fact. Dude's going to be knocking on 70's door soon. I don't want to see 70-year-old Ric Flair, nor do I want to see 62-year-old Hulk Hogan.
It's like watching Ron Jeremy still fuck.
Pretty much. Yeah. I don't want to see that. Nobody wants to watch their grandfather doing business. Nobody. Except maybe Ed. He's smirking right now.
Well, every now and then it's fun. It's funny to watch.
They have certain porn channels for that, my friend.
Yeah.
If it was Paige.
Speaking of Paige. I know she's out with an injury. I know we talked about her little amateur porn gimmick every chance we got during WrestleMania last night.
It was a neck injury.
She actually made
a statement. I believe it was on Twitter about like 3 days ago. You know, standing by with what she originally believed in. You know, that was on her phone. And this, that, and the other thing. And you know,
I said the same thing. It's your personal life.
Right.
What she does in her house is her business.
Albeit it sucks that you put it on your phone. maybe lesson learned.
Right.
But no, I don't think anybody thinks any fucking different of you.
I don't.
It's just the way it is.
It's a fun joke to make every now and again.
Yeah, absolutely.
I'd love to see her come back just as strong and as awesome as she was before she left.
Yeah, we were all fans of her before it happened. We were actually excited. We got to see a little bit more of her. Some of it was weird.
Yeah.
After Pam and Tommy Lee, after Tanya Harding.
Nothing surprises me anymore.
I just don't care.
Yeah, exactly. That shock factor's
that
gone.
That teen pregnant bitch. Like,
fucking
just don't
shock
care.
Factor's gone.
It is.
Now
we wait for it.
Take Brooke. Quick break, and be right back.
That's right. We'll close out the WrestleMania talk and get into top 10.
Sounds good. Quick break. Be right back.
Quick break.
I kept hearing this fucking. Love boobs.
Absolutely.
We love beer.
I love beer. And I love boobs. So you have me right now. You have my attention.
Well,
you had me at we. Mm-hmm.
The fine folks at Jelly Belly Belly Bean.
Oh, wow.
Decided they wanted to.
What do you want to corner the corner market here or something?
Make a draft beer, alcohol free jelly bean.
You know, it's bad enough they make jelly beans that taste like fucking puke and fish now.
I know. So my mom picked these
up. Take my money.
Yeah, right? Here, just open my wallet. Take what you take what you want.
I think two should probably.
Mama Smith, if you listening?
Two should give you a good.
Two?
Good flavors. Three, all right, just well, I got three. Case.
Mama Smith, if just they got vodka flavored jelly beans.
Okay.
Hook a brother up.
Right? There are some on the jelly bean boxes. Three.
You got three.
There are some on the jelly bean boxes that say, like, how to make like a margarita one. Dude, it smells like natty ice.
It does smell like
natty. Grab yourself a natty daddy and get you some Jelly Belly. It all rhymes.
It smells canned.
It smells like every Navy bar I ever stepped foot into, and I was never in the Navy. I'm afraid to eat this now. I'm watching all you guys, but you're smiling and you're kind of off-put. All right, fuck it. Here I go. It tastes like natty ice, too. Hot shit. Don't spend your money. Thank you, Mama Smith. We're glad to try anything, but, dude, give those to your kids. Give those to Evan, for fuck's sake. I like Evan.
Have him bring him to school or something.
Right? Show and tell.
What? It's just candy.
I got beer jelly beans. Mm. No.
All right. They don't suck, but they're not good.
They don't suck. But it's like chewing. Seriously, it's like chewing a Schlitz. Oh, my God.
I've actually had a Schlitz.
But have you ever chewed one?
Oh, God.
Yeah. When you
That was like a Bud Ice.
Oh, God.
That's what that tasted like.
Do they
like.
Still make that?
I don't know, but so. If they do, they should be shot. That was some terrible
they
shit.
They shot that with the penguin.
Oh, my God. One of the things we forgot to talk about last night when we discussed Roman Reigns bullshit versus The Undertaker legend. The return after probably the hardest 2 weeks of his life of good old JR to the commentary booth. How awesome was that to
you know
hear
how awesome
that man's
it was?
Voice?
They signed him to a 6-month contract.
Nice.
That's how awesome that is
good.
Right there.
Good. So loses his wife. 2 days later, 3-4 days later, loses the wife's cat. Just dies of loneliness. How that? I know animals do that. I've seen it.
Animals get
it.
Especially cats. Cats are attached to people. It's funny. It's funny because I always write, not my cats, because it's the truth. They're not my cats. And cats know that. Mm-hmm. The cats look at me as one thing. I feed them. That's the reason why
you're
they
the
don't fucking
human.
That's the reason why they don't fucking scratch me or do fucking rude things because they understand like I will cut off their fucking food supply.
Good.
I wake up in the morning and I will not feed their asses. They
my cats love me so
they try to be
you
assholes
probably
one day.
Dote on those.
You know
cats.
What Mike did? Mike walked right out that fucking door and went right to work and those fucking cats were like,
oh, our kids do that every
all
day.
All right, he's gonna come back. Any minute now.
Right. Our kids, look, truth be told, Angela and I in our house, the kids do that every day. They don't do it out of malice. They're just fucking lazy. Did you feed your demons today? Oh, I forgot. Good. They've been without food for 8 fucking hours. Do something about it. Right now? Are you serious? I'm building a Minecraft. Get off your fucking gimmick and feed the cats.
That's different.
Whoa, 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 whoa. No, not Minecraft.
Get off the fucking gimmick
no,
and do
Minecraft.
Your job.
You feed
hey,
the cats.
Speaking of which, real quick, before we do go into the top 10.
I never really played Minecraft.
Brought up a real... No, I haven't either, but you watched it, obviously. And you've watched it, too, right?
Which is?
Minecraft. Mm-hmm. You've seen it. You've seen it in action,
I play
right?
7 Days to Die, a zombie crafting
my kids,
game.
Yeah. My kids are like big time. Like big time at one point in a fucking Minecraft. The shit that they created. Now, a little jealous that we didn't get to fuck with shit like that back then?
No, because we built forts and shit. We did Minecraft with our hands.
We still did that. I hear you, but
I am still a little jealous.
Not to that
but
level,
we still,
though.
But we still.
The closest we had was Sim City.
Yeah,
or something
I remember
like that.
Something like
right?
That.
Yeah, exactly. But I mean, you really look at these graphics; they're 8-bit graphics, dude. You know what I'm saying? They're it's nothing. It's nothing huge, but I mean, it's the world.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? It's how it is, and I've
watched some of these kids build castles, build running rivers, farms.
Things you can hit a button and trigger one thing to open, like physically, right. Like it's insane what they can do on
this.
Am
I jealous of that? No, let them have their fun. I do get a small tad bit envious, thinking, you know, that would have been cool to have when I was.
That's my point.
Old,
let's not say jealous. Let's say envious. Would that have been kind of cool to have that during, sure. Say, because like we were the same way. I don't think I wouldn't have not went outside and played football. You know what I'm saying?
Our parents maybe get a little jelly of us when we could take our music with us in a pocket where everything they had
they stole our shit. That's what
right. Theirs was. It's in the house. It's this big monstrosity of a stereophonic record player with 24-inch speakers and whatnot, because they didn't sell them little. But again, everything evolves and everything changes. Mm-hmm. I'm quite sure that, you know, when I first saw an iPod, like, wait, that little gimmick right there has 10,000 songs in it?
All those songs.
I used to have to stash two cassettes in this pocket, two cassettes in this pocket, and one in the pocket of my jean jacket.
And that was getting me through half the day. After that, I had to break
I just
the
wanted
fucking
choices.
Jacket.
I don't know if it gave me that many options, but I wanted choices. You know, Kiss, Metallica, Tom Jones, this, that, whatever. You know, you had something for everybody or for you. But, I could see myself at 11 or 12 being happy with Minecraft. But I won't trade what we had for the world.
Oh, God, no. That's what I'm saying. I'm not going back in time and fucking inventing Minecraft. Is what I'm saying is, you know, it is kind of cool, like, seeing – like when you turn around and you say some of these kids don't have, like, an imagination, and it's like they – you know, they kind of do. So,
well, yeah, you're right. But is it computer assisted imagination? I mean, us, we went outside, we picked up a stick, and it was either a gun or a sword, and you role played, you had fun. It does take imagination to do what some of these kids can do on these Minecraft games.
Yeah,
it really does. But still, I would like to throw them outside with a stick, a rubber ball, and a rake and say, have some fun.
So some cop can shoot them? Brilliant.
Yes.
Anyway.
Yes.
Actually, this game
did
here...
Did the kid deserve it?
This
yes.
game here is on Steam, and I haven't tried it yet, but I want to grab it. It's called Scrap Mechanic, mm-hmm. and I don't know if you remember like the robotics toys or the... they're like toys you hooked up together, and you connected the motor to it, and it would make a working car or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's literally a computer game where you put together. I don't know if you guys can see the screen here. I guess.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Oh
yeah.
Wow!
And literally, you can create these machines with this game.
That's pretty freaking stellar,
like,
right there.
You can create working doors, and there are people that have made houses that can turn into cars.
Santa Claus
and stuff. Yeah, those are the workers.
Tanta.
They're scrap mechanics.
Tanta.
Wow. Yeah, things like that. The innovations that they have today for some of these games are fantastic. And we're all video gamers here. You remember, you know, Blades of Steel, the old hockey game for Nintendo.
Yeah.
And now I look at my NHL 17, and I'm like, look how far we've come.
Look at Nintendo Pro Wrestling.
Oh, I know. And versus now WWE 16 or whatever we're playing.
They're at 17 right now.
Yeah, they are.
Which not impressing me.
I don't think
it's that much better.
I always get every other year. Just like Madden, I get every other year. I don't want to have to go out every year, buy a new fucking platform. Every other year is fine. Get two
actually,
years work out of it.
Remember, I don't. You guys remember?
I still play Madden 11 right now. That's how much I love 11.
I know.
They used to have the what is it? Back in the 80s, they had the Micro League Baseball game.
Yes.
Remember that?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Well, I don't know if you knew this, but for the Commodore 64, there was a Micro League Wrestling game.
Yes,
and it was WWF based.
Yeah.
It was
WWF. That's right.
Yeah.
And it was literally like you had to highlight the move you wanted to do.
Yeah.
It was like,
you know, I just saw a screenshot of that the other day.
Yeah. Yeah. I never actually got to play it, but it had Jesse Ventura and Vince mm-hmm. McMahon were the commentators.
Yeah.
I remember that. Yeah.
I remember those drop menus too.
All right. So we're gonna have this. We're gonna have Matt from Pistol Pete's call real quick.
Oh, Big Matt.
Big Matt's gonna be giving us a big shout. Let us know real quick because he's gonna get that. Get that thing going for us on Saturday. Don't forget this Saturday, which he's going to probably plug. This Sunday.
Saturday is the Eternal Flames birthday party at Tokyo
which
Sushi.
We will be at Tokyo Sushi.
Yes, got a special
blast.
Song picked out.
Interested.
Mm. Be interested all you want. Show your ass up. That's a hashtag not my birthday.
hashtag
39.
I ain't going to get my ass whooped. Don't get these Jelly Belly beer bears, man, because these things are freaking weird.
I have one feeling, and they hurt them.
The worst thing is you couldn't just swallow it. You know
like
what I'm saying?
Harry Potter jelly beans. Those are how they are.
Oh, Birdie Bots,
every flavor bean. Oh,
God, dude.
No, thank you.
Earwax.
See, the worst part is like I'm like a Skittles. I guess you'd call it a Neo Skittle. Like I can't just do one Skittle at a time.
Oh, same. You got to combine them. No, same. Guilty as hell. I'm going to take the red one and the green one. And
I'm not sure if that added a brick to the wall or not.
No. We just took 10 feet off the wall, man. You see the flavors on the back. You're like, oh, if I combine this one and this one. Oh!
I can't just do one. I know you're supposed to be like, ooh, grape.
No, horseshit.
Ooh, cherry.
I'm going to take the cherry and the lime, and it's going to remind me of...
The same anyway.
I have a little cherry.
No, they don't.
No, there's some about the green ones.
If you combine the cherry and the lime, it reminds me of the old Sonic cherry limeade from back in the day when I was a kid. Oh, nothing like a good cherry limeade.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Remember they had I forget what brand soda it was, but it was cherry...
Snapple.
Fanta had a cherry limeade soda.
It was
Snapple.
Was it Snapple?
The cherry limeade?
Yeah, but it was Ricky. Remember, it was Ricky...
Snapple sodas.
Yes.
They used to have Snapple sodas. Yes. They were like $2.
Yes, that's what it was. Yeah. Oh, it was right next to that, because we would go into the Charlie's package store. You can go in there because they had sodas.
Yep.
You know, so we would walk in there and get our sodas, and it'd be right
back
there.
Back before everything
cherry
was
Cherry Lime Ricky, that's what it was. Cherry Lime Ricky.
And they had Jolt.
And now they have pictures up on the wall that says, you can't come in unless you're with a parent at 20. Fuck that.
Exactly.
We used to go across the street from the ball field to the packy because they sold soda, got our sodas, went back to playing ball.
Fuck yeah, exactly.
Bunch of wussified baby millennial bitches.
We drank soda. We
that's a different episode. Sorry. Ashley Junt. That's all I got to say. I'm bringing it back.
Calling this motherfucker.
It's okay. I'm bringing it back.
I'm calling
you're not bringing it back.
See what he says.
All right. Big Matt. The number you have dialed is no longer in service.
You can't do that.
And you can't teach that.
Oh, I told you never call me again.
Hello?
Hey, is Matt around?
Yep. Hold on one second.
Hello.
What's up, brother?
What's going on, man?
Nothing. All right, so...
Nothing.
We had...
Hold on one second. Babe, you got to take him. I can't... Hold on one second, Mike.
Sure.
Nothing?
Yeah, really.
What am I paying you for?
That's what I always say. That's my catchphrase, baby.
What, nothing?
Right, nothing. Hello? Nothing. What's up, my man? You. So, anyways...
What's going on, man?
We had at the beginning of the show, we had our man Blair Tugman calling in, and we've been telling the people about this nice little promotion that you got running. So why don't you let them know what you got going for this Sunday?
It's a little thing we got going on for a pistol piece on Sunday, April 9th, and it's we've got WWE Hall of Famer Tony Atlas coming. But of course he couldn't call in because I told you that earlier. But it's gonna be fun. It's all kid orientated. It's going to be, I'm sure you already plugged it, so it's probably like a replay of the whole thing, but it's $20 for a combo, autograph combo, but I got a lot of merchandise I'm going to be selling too, like his old magazines from the 80s when he was on the cover of them. And
oh, wow.
I've got a couple figures coming in too, so I'm just hoping the figures get shipped, even though they say priority. You never know.
Right.
Yeah, right.
And hopefully when you ordered those, you went to LokinJabroni.com and used the Amazon link.
No, I used the eBay link.
Okay, fair enough. eBay's good. We got to get eBay.
Yeah, eBay's a good
We need to make
link.
Some money.
That's the way you go, baby, right there.
Oh, just for a little side note. Boy, I don't know if you guys are plugging in, but boy, they're bashing Roman hard on the WWE on Raw.
I'm bashing Roman hard, motherfucker.
Dude, we are all bashing Roman
hard. Oh, man,
they were
swearing at him the whole night. It was crazy. My son was just watching it. He couldn't get his interview off just because he beat the dead man. It was hilarious.
Oh, that's freaking awesome. Well, I'll tell you what. We said that we wanted to make him be heel. That's the way you do it, is having beat the
end. Every time he went to go talk, they booed the shit out of him. My son was laughing. They were swearing at him and everything. Every time he went to put a microphone to it.
Oh, that's right. Raw's on right now.
Wow, that is awesome. Hey, while we got you on
the gallows right now.
While we got you on the phone real quick, which was the worst night of the match last night, what'd you think?
The worst match?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Damn, I don't know. Like I said, my son, like, he was devastated on a couple of them, but that's because it's hard to say. I mean, because everybody knew what was going to happen. But everybody was trying to say, too, for some reason, they were saying Samoa Joe was supposed to come out there.
I was waiting for some Samoa Joe,
We just talked about that with Pitbull when he was on the phone. I was waiting because that's Triple H's paid assassin, and he doesn't even show up.
Yeah, exactly.
My son said, well, because my oldest son, he follows it a lot with the behind-the-scenes stuff, and they said he was supposed to do the plug because Brock's supposed to be going back to MMA anyway.
Really?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you won't be surprised if you see Samoa and Brock at the payback.
Interesting.
Yeah, if he, especially if he turns around and does that shit again, man, then
right.
Yeah, he needs to make a decision. He needs to get the fuck out of the business then if that's all he's going to do. Best.
But yeah, too, on another side note too, Mike, I got that up for another one that'll be in the works for us too. Is the 29th? It's just not. I can't say it's a definite. I won't know till Wednesday, but that one's going to be basically set in stone too.
Oh, nice, nice. Okay, all right. So we're going to have to start letting people know about that.
The hurricane part of the situation isn't going to be getting going down. It's going to be spring, so it's only going to be a franchisable day.
Okay.
Oh, I got you. Perfect. Yeah. Perfect.
But yeah, he's set in stone. I just got to make sure what date it is. I already talked to him personally on the phone.
Excellent. All right. Well, we're going to be seeing
I don't know if you told them at all too, but we got Tito Santana coming in May too.
Nice.
Yeah.
Let him do it already. It's just he's got a personal job. He does, and I can put out there what he does. But during the week, it's hard to get him. So he's coming once summer hits.
Hell yeah! I'll come see Tito Santana.
I just mentioned him.
Yeah, you did.
I'm gonna get him and Nikolai Volkov on a combo. I talked to Nikolai Volkov a lot on the phone too.
Right now, you've got Eddie over in the chair just touching himself in an impure manner. It was fucking fantastic.
It was crazy when I talked to him the other day on the phone. It was funny because I was telling him because I've been buying a lot of his figures, and I told him. I said, that must be a real kicker and must be an adrenaline high. I said, when you can walk into your local Target and go down a toy section and see like 25 of your figures with your face on it.
Yeah.
Yeah, at first it was kind of crazy, but now it's just, I'm used to it.
Well, yeah, I was in Maine last weekend before, and we ended up at the Walmart up there, and they have the WWE section, literally DVDs and all this. This is a giant Walmart, beats anything we got around here. And I was looking at Magnificent Morocco and John Studd and all these old school guys, and the kids are loving it. I'm like, man, I thought to myself, and you just echoed my exact sentiment. How cool would it be if I were an older, past wrestler, walking down that and seeing like there's Barry Windham, Arn Anderson, Tully Blanchard, Magnum, Nikolai, and they look the way they did that you remember them from your childhood. Boy, that's pretty freaking badass.
That is awesome.
Yeah, it's just nuts the way they just even if they didn't have a figure, just for one of them, when they came out to say, wrestling Pontiac, Michigan in front of like 80,000 strong. And I mean, that's crazy. 80,000.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I look at the picture you got for the promo of Tony Atlas, and I know that's a semi-recent picture for an older guy.
Like I said, if he would have called, I talked to him today because he just did WrestleCon he just came back from Orlando. So he was down there for the whole WrestleMania and WrestleCon thing, but. He still goes to the gym almost every day. In his 70s, and
he still looks great.
The top right picture on him, that's current.
You know, if I have to take one picture that night when we're down there with you with Tugman and Atlas, I want to see Tony press you, Big Matt, over his head. Right. That's the picture I want. Oh, I bet he could with ease.
He tells me every time I talk to him, he's shoveling 20-some inches of snow a day, so I'm definitely sure he's still in shape.
He's probably bouncing 500 easily off his chest every day.
I betcha. Mm-hmm. Fuck yeah.
That's what he told me, too. He said, when I was talking to him, he said, hey, you got to put my flyers in the local gyms. He said, I know there's some gym rats that I want to meet.
Oh, heck yes. I mean, nice. Mike was talking about it earlier, that iconic picture that I believe is part of your ad is him pressing Hogan above his head. And it looks like he's barely breaking a sweat. I remember watching that as a kid.
Yeah, exactly. That was fantastic.
And that's the shitty part about that, too, is I had that magazine, too, the same magazine I have. But my son got money in my mind. My son met him when we met him face-to-face, so he knew who I was. In New York, he personalized that one. So, yeah, that one won't be for sale. That one's on my son's wall.
You hold on to that one. Yeah.
All right, bro.
But no, believe me, I got like 12 or 13 other magazines that are going to be for sale. They're all from the 80s with him on the cover. And I got his... shoot interview DVD for sale too. So
nice.
We're looking forward to it. Well, we're going to see you on Sunday, and we're letting everybody else know. Come on down there, see him. That's 29 Stonington Road, Norwich, Connecticut 06360. Make sure you go down there and see. It's kid friendly, $20. Get a picture, get an autograph, 8x10. It's going to be It's going to be gone, man.
Full disclosure, we will not be signing anything except the bill at the end of the night.
Maybe some boobs.
Maybe. Yeah. I'll sign a boob.
But no, what I was going to say, too, is that even don't let nobody get discouraged because it's a Sunday night, because anybody that goes in basically in the North and London County school area, April 10th to the 14th is April vacation. Anyway,
that's
so
right.
No rush to get home because kids don't have any school.
Nice. That's Amen. Even better. Good call. Good call. Yeah. All right. We'll see you on Sunday, bro.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Have a good night, bro. Later.
You too.
That's going to be a fun night. It's going to be a fun night. Yeah, man. Blair Tugman, Tony Atlas, Loki, Jabroni. Maybe we can drag Focus away from his Walking Dead for
Eddie,
one night.
Eddie Focus, it's over, man.
Season premiere.
That was last night.
I got to catch up on that when I get home.
Okay.
Oh, you didn't watch it yet?
No.
Somebody dies.
It's The Walking Dead, man.
I know.
Yeah.
I just wanted to be the spoiler
I pulled that joke and somebody's watching 6 feet
somebody
under.
Somebody got mad, yeah.
Somebody's watching 6 feet under, like, how's that end? Someone dies.
Somebody still gets mad, too.
To quote Bruce Pritchard, what was the finish on that guy?
Righteous! All right, so we're going to go right into this because we are running right on the edge here.
We'll get our plugs in. Got a lot of plugs this week. You know, I kind of won't buy into this video until you can superimpose our heads onto the band members.
I'll do that shit, man.
That'd be pretty badass.
That takes a lot of work.
I know.
We don't have.
I know. It would still be fun.
Normally, I like to go the humorous
route. Go on, Jib Jab.
Okay.
This week, I went a little, I went like my favorite type list.
Grocery?
We've said it before. You know, I'm not a huge Undertaker fan. I'm more of a Kane fan.
Mm-hmm.
I've always liked Kane's. I mean, I like the Undertaker. Don't get me wrong.
Mm-hmm. It's hard not to.
However, there are times that no matter what, whether you're a fan or not, he absolutely takes the show.
Oh, cool. Of course.
Whoever
of course.
He's wrestling with, albeit, it just, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. It just. So I have compiled a list of my top 10 favorite Undertaker matches
mm-hmm.
throughout his 30-plus year career in the WWE/WWF.
I wonder if mine are on.
Some people I felt like he wrestled with, like Stone Cold Steve Austin, they were kind of, you ever kind of felt like they just kind of like were like two paper cutouts going at each other, no matter how.
No, you know what? I think we saw that so many times. It just
maybe that's what it was. It was just so
much. It's like Big Show and Kane.
It's almost like The Rock. Remember The Rock and Undertaker? Same thing. I don't have a whole lot of Rock.
Rock and Triple H.
There you go. Same idea. They just fight so much. You're just like, eh.
Any match involving Ahmed Johnson was the shits. The end. I have to say it. Fuck Ahmed Johnson.
All right. So,
and that's not racist.
Real quick, I want to give my honorable mention to Edge, WrestleMania 24.
Mm.
Obviously, I think this was probably, was right about Edge's last one, right?
Edge's last match, I think, yeah.
Edge always been there. Undertaker at this point in his career was freaking, I think he was the riding demon or whatever he was.
He was back in the black. He wasn't doing the motorcycle gimmick,
right,
but he was
the badass, American badass. Or
was he?
Like that.
I'd have
ass
to look it up.
Or whatever he was. He just started doing the whole, exactly.
The more MMA Undertaker versus the motorcycle Undertaker.
There you go.
Yeah.
There you go. So
he was using the Kimura lock.
Yeah, exactly. It was a very good, it was, like I said, fucking one of those good men. Edge has always been a great wrestler. Mm-hmm. So to see that part of it. Going right into it. Number 10, the Iconic. Nobody will ever forget about it. I don't care who you were, what you were doing. You heard about it. You watched it. You rewound it. The dude's fucking tooth went through his fucking nose. Mankind, Hell in a Cell, the one, the only, King of the Ring, 1998. You lived in a fucking sewer, even then you probably heard about this
damn
match.
To this day, that is the most brutal, iconic, just violent cage match WWF, WWE has ever put on. And I've seen some hellacious cage matches.
The look that he has when he tosses Mankind. Number one, you know he's shocked, but he's still got to keep that, I'm the Undertaker, so I'm evil and I meant to
do that
look. But you know he's thinking, I just killed this dude.
Well, even better, when he does the choke slam and they're told, if you read Foley's book, that the fence on top was double reinforced to sustain Undertaker 325, Mankind 301.
And he went
through it. And when they pan that camera up, completely breaks character. You see the Undertaker just with the face on. And they quickly pull away. But when you watch the tape back and you see that face, that's the moment where he goes, I think I just killed my coworker.
I think I just killed him. Absolutely. Number nine. He just showed up last night. Jeff Hardy, ladder match, Raw, 2002.
Put Jeff Hardy on the map.
Dude.
Honestly, they were a great team, but that put Jeff Hardy in capital. I can lead the show letters.
Exactly.
Until his drug problem.
And not only that, the big man proved he could be with the best of them.
You remember the
match,
end of the match,
man,
where he picks him up by his head and he hugs him live on television? You're just like, he just put Jeff Hardy on the map.
Yes. All big time. Big time. That's
amen. What a great choice.
Number eight, Triple H, Hell in a Cell, WrestleMania 28.
Wasn't bad.
The reason why I like that one, obviously the best friend honor thing, you know what I'm saying? It was at this point, my favorite image of that is the three of them.
Oh, at the top of the ramp.
Exactly. The three of them. That's when I thought it was pretty much over for The Undertaker at that point. You know what I'm saying? I didn't know you were going to keep going after that. I thought that was it, you know, because they already went through the Shawn Michaels thing, blah, blah, blah. That image right there gave me goosebumps. Mm-hmm. When they all stopped and they turned back around. God, dude, that was awesome. Mm-hmm. That was awesome. My boy, number seven versus Bret Hart, SummerSlam 1997. We talked about outdoor venues. I'm pretty sure, if I'm not mistaken, this
New Jersey Meadowlands.
Oh, it was Meadowlands. Okay, yeah. So it wasn't an outdoor. However,
it was outdoors.
It was. Yeah, okay. Yeah. Yes.
The Meadowlands, which became Giant Stadium. Yeah.
One of the when they do these outside, they just seem to have awesome, incredible matches. First of all, you got Bret Hart. I mean, he's the excellence of execution.
He's something, all right.
Also, the excellent, the one that charges $100 to get a
greasy ass Canadian. Fuck that guy. But I got a funny Bret Hart story when we're
great,
done.
What a great fucking match, man! Number six versus Kane, WrestleMania 14. They were going on forever with this whole Brother Kane thing. They had the Inferno match, all these other freaking gimmicks. They finally get a one-on-one match, and it was fucking phenomenal.
Yeah.
Brought the fucking house down. Number five versus Shawn Michaels. We talked about it earlier. Bad Blood, 1997.
The arrival
of Kane kicking down the door.
The first ever appearance of Kane. The first ever Hell in a Cell match.
Yes.
The first time in my memory of watching wrestling where a guy was on top of a cage. The first memory of seeing blood hit the camera and you saw that red spot. They didn't have time to clean it.
Yes.
They were too busy filming. And every time they went to that cameraman, you saw that, that quarter-sized splotch of blood in every shot until the end of that match. What a fantastic choice.
Absolutely, man. Number four, obviously, the one that did it all, versus Hulk Hogan, Survivor Series, 1991.
Did not. I'm glad you put that on the list. Did not see it coming. I thought it would
be the only reason why it's on this list is just because it's iconic. It is just the match.
We're so jaded as fans today, but then everything was they're going to throw the major heel against Hogan. He's going to work with him for 3, 4, 5 months. He's going to drop the leg on him at a pay-per-view, and he's going to move on to the next guy. I certainly didn't see it coming. Ric Flair was a part of it. To see Undertaker win that night, and you often hear the term stunned silence.
It was.
When
shot.
He beats him, the crowd does nothing. And when they say
three.
Yeah. And it's silent. When the guy gets on the microphone and says, your winner and the new World Wrestling Fan. And then the crowd explodes. Stunned silence.
Stunned. Absolutely. That's the reason why this is on the list. Like I said, it
absolutely.
Was one of, and to be, you know, a little bit, I can't put it up high. I can't put it down low. Number three versus Batista, Last Man Standing Backlash 2007. Talk about two big men that know how to fucking brawl.
I got nothing nice to say about
Batista. I'm not a huge Batista fan, but the guy can work when he, obviously, we have one of these people right now, Brock Lesnar. The guy's got every fucking bit of talent in the world. When he has a match with somebody like Undertaker, gold, man, gold. Number two, versus Kurt Angle, No Way Out 2006. What can you say bad about Kurt Angle?
Nothing.
You can't. That dude is fucking amazing. He was the greatest inductee last night for
I can't wait to see
the
full,
Hall of Fame.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you got to give it to him.
I got a good feeling. I haven't seen the Hall of Fame. Don't spoil it for me. I know who's in. I'm not asking you not to spoil that for me. But I have a feeling that the Rock and Roll Express might have stole a little bit of thunder from Kurt Angle. But Angle was the main event last
Angle
night.
Angle is always. He is going to be there. And number one versus Shawn Michaels, WrestleMania 25. I mean, if you thought the streak was ever going to get fucking broken, it was going to be Shawn Michaels that night. You swore. I swore. Everybody swore. And when it didn't happen, you were like this. Remember
and then
that
they did
stunt?
It the year after.
And that's you'll never see that on this because I thought that was hot garbage. I mean, they redid it, and it was
the same match.
Exactly. It was a great match. Absolutely, it was a great match, but it was the same match. This match, however, was the one and only. This, in my opinion, is what...
Oh, I mean, their first match together was gold.
And what, of course, it's Shawn Michaels.
You've ever read any of Jericho's books, it was that match that has him get the itch to come back after a 2-year absence, watching Shawn and Undertaker do their thing.
That was probably one of the greatest matches I've ever had the pleasure of watching.
Oh, yeah.
To be
and
honest
you,
with
you. You hit a couple of mine on there. I'm not going to go any further. I am going to do this. I'm going to shock a lot of people because as people who have known me any longer than 20 minutes or have watched wrestling with me ever, not a huge Undertaker fan, respect the ever-loving shit out of that guy.
I agree. That's why I gave him the list this week.
If last night was his last go... You know what, dude? Thank you. Thank you for...
I'm pretty sure it is.
The 27 years you gave to the WWF
That's a pretty symbolic... that's you can't get any more symbolized than that,
sure.
Man. I mean, like I said, warriors do that all the time. You throw your armor and your shield down, and it's over. And that's pretty much what he did. He put that hat down.
You know, I don't shit on Undertaker for anything that went on last night. He did the right thing. Gary even said he did the right thing. You put over the new guy, you make sure that the business is healthy going forward. I think they could have picked a different guy, but for the 27 years you played that character, you were the man. And for the years prior to that, when you were the skyscraper, Mark Callis, or Texas Red, or the Master of Pain, or whatever gimmick you had, you were the king, dude.
Yep.
You were the king, and no one, everybody says, who's going to be the next? There's never going to be
another. No, there's going to be another Undertaker.
There's only one Undertaker, unless you go to SummerSlam 94, where there were two of them.
Yeah.
Brian Lee. But there's never going to be another Undertaker. Man, my hat goes off.
And Brian Lee slept with the Undertaker's wife.
I did hear that. I did hear that.
Fucking asshole. You get him a job and he sleeps with your wife. What the fuck, man?
It is what it is. A couple of plugs going out. Obviously, Viking Entertainment. You gotta love these guys. And come out and see them on Saturday night at the Eternal Flames 39th birthday. 39th, my ass.
Fuckus Social Media Network.
Yes, the Fuckus Digital Network. I'm guessing that the final touches are done, and Mr. Merrick of the Bearded Truth is a part of the Fuckus Digital Network. While you're picking your nose, do you want to chime in on this?
Because he was giving you the
scratch of my nose.
The bearded, he was giving you the Bearded Truth.
Right. Were you giving me the Bearded Truth right there?
Was I giving you the Bearded Truth?
He was giving you the Bearded Dragon.
I was. That was the Bearded Truth.
Is Mr. America part of the Fuckus Digital Network now? Yeah. Are we going in that direction?
I don't know. He doesn't even have a website. It's not generating income.
Well, if you want to help with that.
Cream.
Dollar bill, y'all.
All right. I got you. Let's talk about www.lokiandjabroni.com and all the fantastic affiliate links that you can find on said website.
Mobile link has been fixed, by the way.
Yes, I just pointed somebody in that direction the other day. He wanted to do some WWE shopping, and he did. So, Eric B. Mitchell, thank you very much for ordering your very expensive stuff.
Send a picture to the Facebook.
Yes, I already told him. When he gets his swag in, he's got to send a picture of his purchase because we want to see it. Let's also thank Stan Tall real quick. I know Ed's not a fan, but that's okay.
I never said anything about Stan Tall.
It's thank a local lawman, dude. Come on.
I have never said anything about Stan Tall.
Another couple quick hits. Originally, Road Warrior Animal Joe Laurinaitis was supposed to be here tonight. He's traveling. He could not be here with us. We are going to get back to him in a couple weeks. But thank you to Blair Tugman, and thank you to Pitbull number one, Gary Wolf, for...
always good insights. Always,
and they're good friends, man. I'm telling you, there's not a time where Mike or myself can't talk to Joe or Gary or Blair through the magic world of social media.
And don't forget, guys, this Sunday, April 9th, we will be down there 8 to 10. Come see Tony Atlas. Come see Blair Bullshark himself. Get them autographs. $20, kid friendly.
Bring a Chipwich.
Bring a Chipwich.
Vanilla Chipwich.
Well, not this one, because
he's, oh, no, he's not still before training. The fight. He's after the fight.
We got to bring it to him.
Yes. And
that's the deal.
One last plug for me personally. We've talked about it before, and it's all of us, really.
Yeah.
April is Autism Awareness Month, so we're trying to raise money for autism awareness. All you have to do is make a donation to the charity of your choice that involves autism. If you do it on your gimmick phone, screenshot it. If you do it on your laptop, take your little phone.
Get a little printout.
Yep, print it and send it to us. We want to know if we get to $500, Eddie is going to shave the chin biscuit live here on the show. If we get to $1,000, the chin biscuit goes and both the mops on our head are gone. If we get to $2,000, we're going to take Eddie for a full body wax. Yes.
No, he's going to get...
We're going to wax taxation is theft in my chest.
Right.
Love it.
Exactly. And if we can get anything beyond $2,000, we'll just be eternally grateful.
We're going to be albinos with not a single shred of hair on our bodies.
If you know anybody, and 1 in 6 people in this world know someone affected with autism, 1 in 68 children in this world have some form or level of autism.
Some kids might be on the spectrum and you wouldn't even know.
Exactly. Yeah. This is very important. Last year we did cancer. This year we're talking about autism. The month of April, get out there, dig into your pocket. Maybe you don't go to Starbucks today. You give that $5 to an autism charity and you screenshot it and you send it to either the Loki and Jabroni Show website through our email, or you screenshot it and you send it to the Loki and Jabroni Show Facebook page. We want to know. And by April 30th, we want to have as much money as we can from you guys going to autism charities.
It's a great cause.
In fact, if you go to my personal Facebook page, a lot of you guys who watch the show, I've accepted as friends or listened to the show, as it were. My profile picture right now says "Light It Up Blue for Autism." Tonight didn't have any clean blue laundry, but guess what? For the next 3 weeks that we do this, I'm going to be wearing blue every single week.
And for those of you that really like the show and want to have something to show for it, go on the Patreon page, www.patreon.com/LokiAndJabroni.
Yep.
Or go to Loki and Jabroni website. It's got all the links to go there. And
get in on the t-shirt
of the month club. Yep. There's two levels. You can get on a t-shirt every month, or you can get one every 2 months if you can't afford to shell out the full amount.
I am quite looking forward to the first t-shirt. Yep. That's going to be my favorite, I think.
That's a guaranteed t-shirt every month. And you help the show.
Right. Yeah. Just make sure that when you donate, you let us know what t-shirt size you need. Because if we send you a medium and you're a triple XL, we can't help you.
Yeah. Not at all. All right, guys. Have a great night. We'll see you guys next week. And for you guys listening to us on Saturday, we'll see you on Sunday.
Get out. See us.